Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sand and Steel, The D-Day Invasion and the Liberation of France, by Peter Caddick-Adams. Narrated by Derek Perkins. Supreme Headquarters, Allied Expeditionary Force. Soldiers, sailors and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark upon the Great Crusade, toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hopes and prayers of liberty-loving people everywhere march with you. In company with our brave allies and brothers in arms on other fronts, you will bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world. Your task will not be an easy one. Your enemy is well-trained, well-equipped, and battle-hardened. He will fight savagely. But this is the year 1944. Much has happened since the Nazi triumphs of 1940 to 41. The United Nations have inflicted upon the Germans great defeats in open battle, man to man. Our air offensive has seriously reduced their strength in the air and their capacity to wage war on the ground. Our home fronts have given us an overwhelming superiority in weapons and munitions of war, and placed at our disposal great reserves of trained fighting men. The tide has turned. The free men of the world are marching together to victory. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. Good luck. And let us all beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking. Dwight D. Eisenhower. Introduction. Tuesday, 6th June, 1944, was a day like no other. Although every military operation has a D-Day, in the popular mind, there is only one D-Day. As Robert Capper, the acclaimed war photographer, who found himself on Omaha Beach that morning, observed, "From North Africa to the Rhine, there were too many D-Days, and for every one of them we had to get up in the middle of the night. It was massively overinsured against every conceivable setback or adversity, making the 24 hours of the longest day one of the best-prepared military endeavors of history." Sand and Steel charts the lifting of the German yoke from a small corner of Normandy during one day, but it was an enterprise that involved millions of people. Hence, this is also the story of a generation, the majority of whom were born across the world in the decade 1916 to 26, and who are no longer with us. We know them as heroes, but for them, the Second World War sucked in all their contemporaries. They were all involved. It was something everyone participated in, and, if fortunate, survived. They did not see themselves as heroes, and many were reluctant to discuss their wartime years. However, I was lucky enough to meet a dozen D-Day veterans, including Lord Lovat's piper, Bill Millin, willing to talk, on the sands of Normandy as far back as July 1975. That was the genesis of Sand and Steel. Since then, I have spoken to over 1,000 Second World War veterans, whenever I have found them. It was in 1991, in the aftermath of the First Gulf War, that I first interviewed Kingston Adams, a platoon commander on D-Day, about his wartime experiences. Before I could ask my first question, he began, "Let's start at the beginning, because by far the most important part was rehearsing for it, getting it right." The regular army officer, commissioned into General Sir, as he was in June 1944, Bernard Montgomery's regiment, the Royal Warwick's, and who retired as a lieutenant colonel, was quite correct. From him and many other interviewees came the dawning realization that D-Day had a vitally important hinterland. For those associated with that iconic day, 6th June 1944 was simply the culmination of months, sometimes years, of dedicated training. The first day of the landings in Normandy and subsequent campaign was only half the story. When compared with the Germans, most servicemen who assaulted northern France had experienced an incredible degree of rugged and realistic training, that put them at the peak of physical fitness, acclimatized them to battle, and equipped them, mentally and physically, well enough to win. Overlooked until now is the incredible statistic that more lives were lost preparing for D-Day than in its 24 hours. It is an uncomfortable aspect of Overlord entirely airbrushed from history. Most accounts plunge straight into the combat, with no more than a cursory nod to what went before. The reader will find that Sand and Steel spends an equal amount of time examining the plans and training that made success on D-Day possible. Without this, previously unexplored and sometimes necessarily dangerous preparation, the airborne troops would not have prevailed, and the seaborne warriors, wet, miserable with seasickness, cold, and under intense fire, would not have known how to drag themselves through the obstacles and off the shingle. Some of this hinterland also included the largely forgotten American occupation of Britain during the war years. For North Americans, the journey to Normandy emphatically did not start on a plane or in a landing craft off the French coast, as suggested by some movies and documentaries. That would be to ignore the presence of Canadian troops in Britain from 1940, and the incredible build-up and training of American forces in the United Kingdom, which began in January 1942 and peaked at 1.6 million GIs stationed in Britain by the end of May 1944, including 385,000 personnel operating the bombers and fighters of the 8th and 9th Army Air Forces, 17,000 female staff with the Army Nurse Corps, 8,000 Women's Army Corps personnel serving across the U.S. Army. To these, we ought to add 122,000 sailors of the U.S. Navy, plus 7,000 from the U.S. Coast Guard, and over 1,000 American Red Cross civilian volunteers. The impact on the resident population, numbering 47 million of the 3 million Americans who passed through Britain during 1942-5, was both profound and lasting. Canadian and other Allied service personnel, principally the Free French and Polish forces, stationed in Britain in 1944, amounted to another 250,000. The effect was further exaggerated because several million Britons were away serving in their armed forces and merchant navy overseas. The transatlantic arrivals meant that well over 10% of the adult male population in Britain, aged between 18 and 40 in 1944, were Americans, including 130,000 black troops, an ethnic group then almost unknown. The legacy lingers to this day in NATO, with Anglo-American intelligence sharing. It has lasted politically with the so-called special relationship, the 9,000 children born out of wedlock to GI fathers, and the offspring of the tens of thousands of wartime brides the departing servicemen took home. Very many voices speak from these pages about their experiences, Americans, Canadians, Britons, and French, from generals and politicians to the private in his foxhole. To balance the narrative of Sand and Steel, there are numerous Germans who provoke the conclusion that the Wehrmacht waiting in Normandy was extraordinarily poorly led, abysmally trained, and shoddily equipped. While it is true that the reinforcements rushed to Normandy after D-Day contained a leavening of steely-eyed, Nazi-motivated killers, those facing the assault troops on 6th June, apart from a few Fallschirmjäger, paratroops, and panzermen, were generally past their prime, recovering from wounds received in Russia and often not even German. Jack Heath, serving aboard LCT 522 at Juno Beach, recalled his first sight of captured Germans at Courseul. Loaded onto his craft to take to England were about 200 prisoners of war. We were shocked by the ages of some of them. They looked like children and old-age pensioners, though some were tough-looking guys. If the reader is seeking confirmation of the view that, in terms of kit, training, tactical ability, tenacity, and sheer guts, fighting without air cover or naval gunfire support, and hampered by interference from Adolf Hitler, the German army was undoubtedly the best army in the field, they will not find it here. Normandy has become a second home for me, to the extent that I have been guiding tours over its terrain for service personnel, business leaders, politicians, veterans, their families, history classes, and the curious for over 30 years. When walking the ground, The majority of questions I am asked still reference either Cornelius Ryan's epic account The Longest Day, first published in 1959, the subsequent film released 3 years later, or Steven Spielberg's Saving Private Ryan of 1998. This is because the interpretations of Ryan and Spielberg still dominate the D-Day story. Thus, Sand and Steel is also an examination of how our understanding of D-Day has changed over the intervening decades. A good reason for this fresh look at the campaign to liberate France on its 75th anniversary is the ease with which the battlegrounds can now be visited and experienced. I have watched the fields of France morph from anonymous beaches, meadows, and towns into tourist sites adorned with plaques, statues, and memorials of almost Gettysburg proportions. The narrow, tree-flanked lanes have widened into highways shorn of their foliage. Overwhelming hedgerows, the famous bocage that loom large in everyone's recollections, are now trimmed to insignificance or ripped out altogether. Farmhouses that hosted headquarters and aid posts, still evidently bomb-damaged to the visitor of the 1970s, have been demolished to make way for the new. Industrial estates and modern housing, particularly around Caen, Carentan, and Saint-Lô, adorn the once contested landscape. Graffiti today decorates the coastal bunkers that are left. Most have been demolished over the years, where in 1975 ammunition from the war years was still to be found, and as much of it as possible transported back to England in my schoolboy pockets. What is left these days is well signposted, even if the acres of car parking seem overdone. The process has been gradual, as other generations beyond the veterans have taken an interest, but need assistance to understand what took place. This is why you will find the occasional modern impression of the 1944 terrain in these pages. In writing Sand and Steel, I was struck by how much the sea dominates the story of the liberation of France. The bulk of the invasion forces arrived by sea. It was naval gunfire support onto the German defenders that enabled the Allies to land. And without the massive maritime sustainment of Admiral Sir Bertram Ramsay's Operation Neptune, the Allied coalition would not have broken out into France. To beat the Germans, across the water came an inventory of 700,000 separate items, from 137,000 jeeps, trucks, and half-tracks, 4,217 tanks and fully tracked vehicles, and 3,500 artillery pieces, to a replacement rail network with 1,800 steam locomotives, £240 million of potatoes, 54 million gallons of beer, 26 million jerry cans, 16 million tons of fuel, food, and ammunition, 15 million condoms, 10 million bags of vomit, 2.4 million tent pegs, 1 million gallons of fresh drinking water for the first 3 days alone, 800,000 pints of blood plasma, segregated carefully by black and white donors, 300,000 telegraph poles, 260,000 grave markers, cigarettes, toothbrushes, and 210 million maps. If warriors striding through the surf on D-Day can be assessed as beginning the end of the European war, then for the United States, Canada, and Britain, their respective wars also began with water. In America's case, literally with Pearl Harbor. For Canadian troops, it was the long trip across the Atlantic. Whilst British soldiers equated their rescue from the waves at Dunkirk 4 years earlier as the beginning of their fight back against Nazi Germany. In June 1944, sometimes it was the same British soldiers who were to wade from the same English Channel onto French sand and turn the tables on their former oppressors. Occasionally, some of the ships that had rescued troops from Dunkirk would make the return journey too. One of the takeaway impressions offered by Saving Private Ryan was the primacy of US forces on D-Day. Whilst this would be true later on during the campaign to liberate France, 6th June 1944 perhaps represented Britain's last hurrah. A significant proportion of the maritime and land forces deployed on the day of invasion were British. Even in the US sector, for example, of the 15 major troop transports and landing ships which lay off Omaha Beach feeding troops ashore, 8 were British and 7 American. Additionally, the navies of Canada, France, Poland, Norway, the Netherlands, and Greece amounted to a substantial presence. However, this is not a flag-waving exercise. American, British, and Canadian manned landing vessels operated equally off all five landing beaches, for on D-Day, in the words of the Supreme Commander General Dwight David Eisenhower, there was only one nation, allied. Apart from Ike's battle cry, for students of modern military history, D-Day is the epitome of a tri-service operation, one where the maritime, air, and land components were of equal importance, and totally reliant on each other for victory. These pages, therefore, explain the build-up and invasion from the viewpoint of those flying gliders, transports, fighters and bombers and their ground crew, of the sailors manning warships, troop transports and landing craft, as well as those on both sides of the beach. It is a timely reminder that at a time when alliances and budgets are under strain on both sides of the Atlantic, no one country or arm of service could have succeeded alone. It was a time when every nation needed not just partners, but extraordinarily close friends, who were prepared to put their own young men in harm's way in pursuit of a greater cause. Freedom. Part 1. Preparation. I thank God you are here, and from the bottom of my heart I wish you good fortune and success. Winston Churchill, inspecting U.S. troops in Britain, 23rd March, 1944. 1. France and America. I speak to you knowingly and tell you that nothing is lost for France. The same means that overcame us can one day bring victory. Because France is not alone. She has a vast empire behind her. This war is not limited to the unfortunate territory of our country. This war is not decided by the Battle of France. This war is a world war. Whatever happens, the flame of French resistance must not be extinguished and will not be extinguished. Extract from Charles de Gaulle's Appeal of 18th June 1940. For Britons, 18th June is the anniversary of the Battle of Waterloo. At a pinch, some might associate the date with Churchill's "This was their finest hour" speech, delivered that afternoon in 1940 to the House of Commons. The Prime Minister was responding to the French request for an armistice with Hitler, announced earlier. However, another, far more important speech was made that day, well known to the French, but largely overlooked by the Anglo-Saxon community. It would ultimately prove to be more significant than Churchill's call to arms. Colonel Charles de Gaulle, an officer of the French army, had twice stalled the Wehrmacht with his 4th Armoured Division, virtually the only offensive actions of the May 1940 campaign. For this, he received his promotion to Général de Brigade, the rank he would adopt for the rest of his life. At the same time, Prime Minister Paul Reynaud appointed him Junior Minister for National Defence and War, with responsibility for coordination with the British. Surrounded by defeatist figures like Maxime Weygand, Charles Unziger, Pierre Laval and Philippe Pétain, de Gaulle twice flew to London, on 9th and 16th June, reciprocating Churchill's 4 visits to France made at the same time, planning to carry on the fight from French North Africa. After the latter meeting, de Gaulle returned to France to find he was no longer a minister and in danger of arrest. Reynaud had been replaced by the aging Pétain, who was seeking an armistice. The break with Pétain was a significant moment in de Gaulle's life, for the Maréchal de France had been de Gaulle's first superior, who had mentored and commanded his protégé throughout the 1920s and 1930s. The younger man had even named his son Philippe in Pétain's honour. On 17th June 1940, de Gaulle, unhappy at deserting his beloved French army and conscious he would be considered by some a traitor, had escaped to London with 100,000 gold francs given him by Reynaud, arriving at Heston Aerodrome with no possessions, no legitimacy, few prospects, but extraordinary self-belief. The following day, over the BBC, and repeated on 22nd June, he appealed to France not to be demoralised and to resist the German occupation. Honour, common sense, and the interests of the country require that all free Frenchmen, wherever they be, should continue the fight as best they may. I, General de Gaulle, am undertaking this national task here in England, he proclaimed. He concluded, I call upon all French servicemen of the land, sea, and air forces. I call upon French engineers and skilled armaments workers who are on British soil, or have the means of getting here, to come and join me. I call upon the leaders, together with all soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the French land, sea, and air forces, wherever they may now be, to get in touch with me. I call upon all Frenchmen who want to remain free to listen to my voice and follow me. Jean-Louis Crémieux-Briac later observed that de Gaulle's appeal brought a light and expressed a French will that nothing had broken down. It maintained, with a single voice, a national tradition, making the link with our entire history. It aroused an indelible recognition, even though listeners did not then associate the idea of France with General de Gaulle. Although the Anglo-American world, to this day, continues to regard de Gaulle with the suspicion first adopted by Churchill, in French eyes, he was nothing less than the saviour of their country. As Crémieux-Briac observed, the appeal of 18th June was like tossing a stone onto the snowy surface of a mountain. Barely a shudder, and then, very slowly, a movement starts which spreads and leads to a slide, which provokes an avalanche and becomes a deafening noise. Thanks to the miracle of radio, because the brutality of the defeat had paralyzed the masses and Pétain's government had silenced the few potential protesters, the date is now part of the national heritage. It is in all history textbooks the benchmark of honor, courage, and hope. It is inscribed in French memories as one of the greatest dates of a great past. One of the many who recalled the broadcast was former French President Valéry Giscard d'Estaing. My mother was a patriot and her father had been at Oxford. She listened to the BBC every day. We heard that a French general would speak and listen to him, but with no idea who he was. Only the day before, Pétain had broadcast his belief that France had been defeated, and he was seeking an armistice with Germany. De Gaulle's speech had a huge effect on us. For the first time, we understood the war was not lost, after all. Capitaine de Corvette, Philippe Kieffer, joined de Gaulle the very next day, though at the time few joined his Free French forces in London. Born to an Alsatian family, Kieffer had been a New York bank director, volunteered for the French Navy aged 40 at the outbreak of war, and the following year heeded de Gaulle's call to arms, joining him in England on 19th June 1940. Described as a torrent of energy, within a year Kieffer had raised the Fusilier Marin Commando, which by 1944 would comprise three troops of 177 hand-picked and extremely well-trained, hardy men. Churchill was less worried about numbers. In June 1940, it was de Gaulle's profile that was of more use to the British Premier, lining up a series of governments in exile to oppose Nazi-dominated Europe. At the height of the Battle of Britain in July 1940 at RAF Odiham, de Gaulle recruited 300 free French pilots to his cause. It was while inspecting their four aircraft that he first saw the Cross of Lorraine, associated with Joan of Arc's resistance to the English, painted on their airframes. Initially angered and embarrassed by its anti-British connotations, he nevertheless realized the emblem's potential as a symbol of resistance. However, by late 1940, de Gaulle commanded only 260 army and naval officers, 2,109 soldiers, and 1,746 ratings. Yet, over time, when they could escape, many Frenchmen and women responded to de Gaulle's vision of an alternative to Pétain's France. Stéphane Hessel made his way to London because de Gaulle inspired me to continue the fight as a Frenchman. Daniel Cordier, a teenager living in Pau in the south, remembered of the armistice. It was unbearable. It made me cry. I went to my room to cry for rather a long time. I told myself this is not possible. Not possible. When Cordier reached London, he found communists, socialists and Jews, all kinds of Frenchmen. We were all young. London was blacked out. We lay down to try to sleep in the dark, all crammed together. We didn't know each other. Then someone started to sing the Marseillaise, and we all joined in. 70 years on, Cordier broke down during the interview at the recollection of what de Gaulle meant to his generation. Even now, it was the most extraordinary moment of my life. To a much younger generation of résistants, such as schoolboy Jean Jam with the Maquis in Épernon, he was a hero, the conscience of France. This one man inspired me. For us, there was no other figure to lead our generation. He was France. No sacrifice would be too great for his vision of our country. All of Kieffer's future commandos were adventurers who had chosen to escape occupied France by various means. Initially, there were just 16. By 1942, their numbers had grown to 23. A year later, 81. They would train hard at Achnacarry Commando School in the Scottish Highlands with other Britons, US Army Rangers, Dutch, Belgians, Norwegians, Poles, and Czechs, learning to climb mountains, wading fast-flowing rivers, running for miles with a heavy pack, and engaging in hand-to-hand combat to earn their Beret Vert and Fairbairn Sykes fighting knives. Kieffer's second-in-command was Guy Atou, a militant anti-fascist who had sailed to London from Brazil and had been broadcasting to France on Radio Gaulle, an anti-Pétain radio station. Also in their headquarters was Maurice Chauvet, born when the Battle of Belleau Wood was raging near Paris, and later sentenced to 10 years hard labour by the Vichy government for attempting to join the Free French Navy. He had arrived in England after 18 months' incarceration on 6th June 1943. Their medical officer, Robert Lyon, and chaplain, Father René du Norroy, were also escapees from Vichy. Norroy, a French friar tuck, not so rotund, but with strong, mischievous eyes, had acted deaf and dumb to cross into Spain and arrived in Liverpool via Barcelona and Gibraltar. Lieutenant Pierre-Marc Azoulay Amaury commanded Kieffer's gun troop, with Francis Guézenec, an 18-year-old Breton, and François Andriot, a 20-year-old French printing apprentice who had cycled from his home in eastern France to reach England via fascist Spain. Guy Vourc, a future pioneer of anaesthesia, who had been picked up floating in the Channel in a near-disastrous attempt to cross in an old boat, led one troop. His brother Francis was second in command of gun troop, with Guy, Comte de Montlore, scion of a family who had survived in the Crusades and originated from the 10th-century castle of Montlore in the Languedoc, as his sergeant. With Atou, they would be known as the Three Guys. They were accompanied by Hubert Faure, a cavalry officer of the 22e Regiment de Dragons, who fought under de Gaulle in 1940, Jean Masson, an apprentice blacksmith, sailor Louis Bégaud, and Parisian Jean Morel, who had escaped by fishing smack to Plymouth in 1940. Lieutenant Alexandre Lofi led 8 troop, whose men included Léon Gauthier, a former bodybuilder from Rennes and gunner on the battleship Courbet, sailor Paul Chouteau, who escaped occupied France by kayak, and orphan Yves Merdal. Chauvet designed their badge, a sailing brig crossed by a commando dagger, still worn by their successors today. On 6th June 1944, these men would be some of the very first to return to France. De Gaulle based himself at 4 Carlton Gardens in central London, waging war through the medium of broadcasts to France via the BBC, rallying right-wing résistants still within France, and unifying them uneasily with the communists, the latter fast becoming a major political influence in the underground. To this day, observed the veteran BBC broadcaster Ed Sturton in 2018, the initials BBC still open doors in Parisian government circles because of the wartime association. Churchill, no mean wordsmith himself, observed, "He might be Stalin with 200 divisions behind his words. France without an army is not France. De Gaulle is the spirit of that army, perhaps the last survivor of a warrior race." In May 1943, de Gaulle moved his headquarters to Algiers after the success of Operation Torch. There, he managed to outmaneuver America's preferred head of the Free French Armed Forces, General Henri Giraud, a more experienced military figure, but political naïf. the switch of allegiance of the pro-Vichy troops to the Allies in Tunisia and Algeria gave de Gaulle a secure power base and a significant army to control. Yet Churchill and he were always at loggerheads. De Gaulle, incorrectly believing the British wanted to seize French colonial possessions, Syria and Lebanon, for example, and trump French interests around the world. His view was that France did not have friends but interests, and he often seemed to antagonize Churchill for the sake of it, if only to prove he was not a British puppet, ironically, speaking German better than English. He was not consulted beforehand over a range of military issues, from the British invasion of Vichy-controlled Madagascar in 1942 to Operation Torch, to which de Gaulle reacted, "I hope the Vichy people will fling them into the sea. You don't get France by burglary." Although de Gaulle and Churchill would go on to forge a curious and mercurial love-hate relationship, the former had sown the seeds for the eventual liberation of his country. In the summer of 1940, as France and much of Western Europe fell under totalitarian domination, many Americans were wondering whether the word conscription might again return to blight their lives. France may have brought notions of liberty to the United States in 1776, but after the French Republic raised an army of 300,000 men through compulsion in 1793, allegedly to defend the country against counter-revolutionary invasion, the concept that every able citizen owed themselves the defense of their nation became another French import. The federal government duly resorted to it on 3rd March 1863 in the Civil War, and on 18th May 1917 during the First World War. The third incarnation of the draft, such an easier word to swallow, came into being on 16th September 1940 through the Burke-Wadsworth Act, passed by wide margins in both houses of Congress. It was the nation's first peacetime resort to the forcible arming of its youth. The new law required all men between the ages of 21 and 35 to register with their local draft boards on 16th October 1940. On that day, in 6,175 offices across the country, slightly over 16 million registered, each receiving a number. 2 weeks later, Secretary of War Henry L. Stimson, symbolically blindfolded with a swatch of material taken from a chair used by the signatories of the 1776 Declaration of Independence, was led to the glass bowl used for the same purpose in 1917. It was filled with 9,000 capsules, each containing a number. Stimson drew one and handed it to President Roosevelt, who called out 158. Incredibly, among the 6,175 registrants of that number was Alden C. Flagg, Jr. of Boston, Massachusetts, whose father had held the first number drawn from the same bowl in 1917. Flagg and his buddies of the 137th Infantry, 35th Division, would cross the Atlantic in May 1944, train in Devon and Cornwall, arriving in Normandy shortly after the 168th anniversary of the Declaration of Independence. Steps had been taken earlier in the year to create the framework for a wartime army through the Selective Training and Service Act. Men voluntarily enlisting into the U.S. Army prior to the spring of 1940 could choose to join the regular army, National Guard, or organized reserve, thus allowing many to beat the draft. After 14th May 1940, all voluntary enlistments were to be into the Army of the United States, a wartime-only national force which actually came into being the following February. By July 1941, 600,000 had been inducted into this army, and in September it absorbed the National Guard. After Pearl Harbor, the Act was amended to require the registration of all men between 18 and 64. Of the millions who complied, 10 million, aged 18 to 44, were inducted into uniform, whether Army, the Air Force then being part of the Army, Navy or Marine Corps. Service was for the duration of the war, plus 6 months. In June 1933, the U.S. Army had numbered 136,000, including 16,000 officers. By 1940, it had increased to 270,000, scattered across 130 posts, camps, and stations. At the outbreak of the Second World War, it amounted to the 17th largest army in the world, just behind Portugal's. It comprised four paper armies with token staffs of a few thousand each, one cavalry and three infantry divisions, a mechanized brigade, 300 primitive tanks in two skeleton armored divisions, and 1,800 aircraft, few of which could be regarded as modern. Even after the First World War, some officers regarded the Air Corps as an adjunct to the cavalry, which led to a much-celebrated regulation of 1920 stating, "Pilots will not wear spurs while flying." The Army Air Corps would only become the U.S. Army Air Force, USAAF, on 20th June 1941, the name by which it was known throughout the Second World War. In 1939, there was no military-industrial manufacturing base to speak of. In any case, Congress and the population were generally hostile to any increased military spending. This was not anti-militarism per se, rather a sense of America first. Cure the Depression, create jobs and restore the country's wealth, then worry about the rest of the world. American industry was simply unable to equip a huge army quickly, supplying rifles, clothing, helmets, tanks, ammunition, bombers, landing ships, and all the rest. The chief factor influencing any American involvement in Europe, should that happen, was shipping capacity. Assuming the Atlantic was clear, which it was not from mid-1941, projections utilizing America's entire merchant fleet still limited the total number of GIs that could be deployed overseas to around 4 million, and only by the end of 1944. American mobilization was well underway before the outbreak of war in December 1941, with over 1.4 million in the U.S. Army spread between 36 divisions and a substantial air component. The earliest troops deployed to the United Kingdom as soon as the following month. Let us join some of them as they set foot on European soil for the first time since 1918. Britain may look a little shop-worn and grimy to you. The British are anxious to have you know that you are not seeing their country at its best. There's been a war on since 1939. For many months, the people of Britain have been doing without things which Americans take for granted. But you will find that shortages, discomforts, blackouts, and bombings have not made the British depressed. You are coming to Britain from a country where your home is still safe, food is still plentiful, and lights are still burning. So it is doubly important for you to remember that the British soldiers and civilians have been living under a tremendous strain. It is always impolite to criticize your hosts. It is militarily stupid to insult your allies. So stop and think before you sound off about lukewarm beer or cold boiled potatoes or the way English cigarettes taste. Thus read a small 7-page foolscap document, Instructions for American Servicemen in Britain, issued from 1942 to all GIs arriving in what was called the ETO, European Theatre of Operations. In fewer than 6,000 words, it offered advice on the peculiarities of the British, their country and their ways, and amongst its first recipients was Private First Class Milburn H. Henke from Hutchinson, Minnesota. He was captured by the world's cameras as the first GI in Britain, disembarking from the troop ship USS Chateau Thierry to a welcoming committee of civic worthies and reporters in Belfast docks. The date was 26th January 1942, as Henke, a 22-year-old who used to work in his father's diner and had joined the National Guard to beat the draft, recalled, "I was sitting on some barracks bags, there were about 15 of us, and this colonel came up the gangplank and demanded, 'I want a man from Company B, 133rd Infantry. I followed, thinking I'd be unloading cargo, until asked if I could talk to reporters. I had to walk down the plank 6 times so photographers could get the perfect shot. With all the attention I got, it looked as though the U.S. Army's plan was for me to win the war single-handed.' The public relations colonel, striding up the gangplank, indicated there was already a sizable American contingent in the British Isles before the Chateau Thierry, a purpose-built troop transport named after an American First World War battlefield, arrived, in company with the Strathaird, the pair transporting the entire 34th Red Bull Division. You will find that all Britain is a war zone, and has been since September 1939. Every light in England is blacked out every night and all night. The British have been bombed night after night and month after month. Thousands of them have lost their homes, their possessions, their families. Soap is now so scarce that girls working in the factories often cannot get the grease off their hands or out of their hair. And food is more strictly rationed than anything else. The Red Bulls were the first of four U.S. divisions to arrive in 1942. The 1st Armoured soon followed, also to Northern Ireland, whilst the 1st and 29th Infantry Divisions crossed later to Scotland and were immediately sent by train to Dorset and Wiltshire. However, they were not the first, for uniformed Americans had been active across the Atlantic for nearly a year, and long before Pearl Harbor. In accordance with Lend-Lease deal protocols agreed the preceding month, in April 1941, construction had begun of four extensive U.S. naval bases, with ammunition stores, repair facilities, offices, hospitals and barracks at Londonderry and Lochearn in Northern Ireland and at Rosneath and Loch Ryan in Scotland. The labour comprised American and local contractors, supervised by U.S. officers, with the projects being funded jointly by both governments. At the same time, an observer group of staff officers was activated in London to reconnoitre potential sites for ground and air force installations. Preceding them were civilian pilots from the United States who had joined the three Eagle squadrons operating in RAF colours between September 1940 and 29th September 1942, when they were absorbed into the U.S. 8th Air Force. Of the many thousands who volunteered, 244 were selected to serve, initially under British squadron and flight commanders, achieving 73 victories. The casualty rate was horrendous, with 94 lost or captured in combat or training, including several US pilots who had served in the Battle of Britain, even before the Eagle squadrons were raised. Other American citizens had elected to join the ranks of the Royal Canadian Air Force, RCAF. Rather than sit out the war in splendid isolation. To them, Britain seemed a natural partner, whilst the plight of France, her ally throughout the Revolutionary War and donor of the Statue of Liberty in 1885, was a deep wound. One Eagle, who later transferred to the USAAF, was Californian Leroy Gover, who crossed the Atlantic to his war from Halifax, Nova Scotia. Preceding the later torrent of GIs, he sailed aboard the SS Emma Alexander in November 1941 with 115 other trained pilots, Americans, Australians, New Zealanders and Canadians. They joined a convoy of 43 other ships, ominously at the height of the Battle of the Atlantic, with U-boats attacking on a nightly basis. We are ordered to carry our lifebelts at all times, even when sleeping, and to sleep in our clothes, he wrote on 22nd November. 2 days later, his diary recorded, "There are now just 37 of us, ships. One tanker went down last night and three others just disappeared." Gover arrived in Liverpool on 7th December, after an uncomfortable and nerve-wracking 16-day passage. The following afternoon at the Air Ministry in London, he was confirmed as an officer in the RAF, against the direction of his own United States. As his train pulled out of Waterloo Station on the morning of Monday, 8th December 1941, Gover read the headline, "Japan Declares War on United States," and was suddenly aware that the European war had become global, with the likelihood that millions of his fellow countrymen would be following him after all. Churchill wrote later that it was then he knew that the United States was in the war up to its neck and into the death. After 17 months of lonely fighting, England would live. Once again in our long history we should emerge, however mauled or mutilated, safe and victorious. Charles Chuck Hurlbut, who grew up in Auburn, New York State, recollected, "Ever since high school I had heard about Hitler and all this stuff in Europe, but I never realized how deeply it was going to affect me. Hitler and Europe, that was their war, don't get involved. I played the clarinet and joined the Auburn Community Band. I was on a bowling team and a softball team. I met a few girls. Everything was going great. Pearl Harbor turned everyone around. I don't think there'll ever be a time again when this country is so unified. I never wanted to be a soldier. That was the farthest thing from my mind. But when something like Pearl Harbor happens, you get a feeling. I'm supposed to do something. I couldn't wait to become 18 so I could be drafted. I wanted to do my part. So when I hit 18, within days I was down at the draft board and registered. Such martial endeavor was despite widespread Middle America's antipathy to intervention, influenced by the Great Depression and memory of losses in the First World War. The much-respected anti-war stance of the Quakers and other religious groups, and fears that much of the USA's Germanic heritage would be put at risk, additionally played their part. Besides, America was not necessarily pro-British. In addition to the powerful East Coast anti-monarchist and Irish-American lobby, many also remembered being taught at school that the Brits were the enemy in the Revolutionary War and had sided with the Confederacy during the Civil War. The America First Committee, too, helped fan the flames of isolationism. With the aviator and influential orator Charles Lindbergh at its helm, at one stage it boasted 800,000 paying members in 450 chapters, though profoundly pro-fascist and anti-Semitic in character. Other advocates of isolationism drew upon history, quoting George Washington's farewell address in which he had advocated non-involvement in European wars and politics. Indeed, for much of the 19th century, the buffers of the Atlantic and Pacific had allowed the United States to remain detached from old-world tensions. Found wanting by naked military aggression in Abyssinia, Spain, and Manchuria in the late 1930s, U.S. neutrality made increasingly little sense after the defeat of France. As a pro-interventionist, Franklin D. Roosevelt, who assumed leadership of his country in the same month as Adolf Hitler took the helm in Germany, was obliged to negotiate with the isolationist-dominated Congress in order to push through aspects of his New Deal and other programs. He was thus powerless to nudge America in his preferred direction, and that of his good friend, the British Prime Minister. The events of Pearl Harbor and Hitler's, in retrospect, bizarre and totally unnecessary declaration of war on the United States, made 4 days after the Japanese attack on 11th December 1941, and reciprocated the same afternoon, changed everything. Until then, U.S. military missions had to be discreet and possessed only limited briefs to observe, scope, but not participate. 2. Atlantikwall. In the east, west, and south are to be found the last resting places of those German soldiers who, for home and fatherland, followed the path of duty to the bitter end. They are a constant reminder to us who remain behind and to our future generations that we must not fail them when it becomes a question of making sacrifices for Germany. Oberst Erwin Rommel, Infantry Attacks. Seated in the front passenger seat next to his driver, Oberfeldwebel Karl Daniel, who had been with him since Africa days, pennant fluttering from the front mudguard, Generalfeldmarschall Johannes Erwin Eugen Rommel spent the first 5 months of 1944 crisscrossing northern France. We know much about these days because he was accompanied everywhere by his Ordnanzoffizier, aide-de-camp, Hauptmann Helmut Lang, and his naval adviser, Vice-Admiral Friedrich Ruger. The pair sat in the back, often keeping company with war correspondents, who were always keen to trail the former Wüstenfuchs, Desert Fox, or followed the Field Marshal's powerful Horsch 951 cabriolet staff car. Lang and Ruger would record everything, both surviving the war. The Horsch took him everywhere. Rommel particularly liked to drop in on his infantrymen, often referred to as grenadiers or Landseer, and the branch with whom he had started his own career in 1910. He frequently carried a pile of accordions in the car, which he enjoyed distributing to the troops, not dissimilar to his nemesis Montgomery, handing out cigarettes and newspapers to his men. Much of the Reich's military tradition was perpetuated by marching songs. There was one for every army and most regions, so all units, however small, boasted an accordion player. Rommel recognized that efficiency in battle came not from bravery but comradeship, the fear of letting down one's mates. He understood that a song around a campfire, accompanied by the wistful notes of an accordion, was a good way of binding his men together for the coming storm. Rommel, as de Gaulle, was another man whose reputation had been forged in 1940. During the invasion of France, it was his 7th Panzer Division that advanced faster, travelled further, took more prisoners, and destroyed more armoured vehicles than any other. Hitler had a special interest in following Rommel's progress, for the young general had previously commanded the Führerbegleitbataillon, guarding his leader's field headquarters during the invasion of Poland. In the bizarre, contradictory, and competitive world that was the Third Reich, advancement often came because of recognition rather than solid achievement. Rommel was a face and a name to Hitler, which then won him his next job, that of commanding a few German troops in North Africa at the beginning of 1941, which turned into something else entirely. In June 1944, the German commander in France was not Rommel, but Generalfeldmarschall Gerd von Rundstedt, who rejoiced in the title of Supreme Commander, or Oberbefehlshaber West, both the person and the office abbreviated to OB West. Assisted by his chief of staff, Gunther Blumentritt, Rundstedt controlled 58 divisions, besides numerous other formations and detachments, totaling around 800,000 troops. These comprised the army's ground combat forces in the West, including France, Belgium, and the Netherlands. Two formations comprised paratroops, 10 were formed from panzers and armoured infantrymen, while 13 were infantry divisions. All these, due to their relative mobility and high-grade personnel, were graded as fit for duty in the East. However, OB West's remaining 23 Bodenständige, static position divisions, were either immobile or reserve infantry formations, with low Kampfwert, combat effectiveness ratings. They were assessed as incapable of taking on offensive missions, and suitable only for limited defence. For the latter's transportation needs, in Rundstedt's domain there were 115,000 military horses on strength, a stark reminder of how reliant on these creatures the German armed forces were in 1944. By contrast, the Allies would bring with them not a single equine. A year earlier, roughly 25% of officers stationed in France had fought in Russia. By 1944, this figure had almost doubled to 60%. This did not necessarily reflect a reinforcement of the West, but a higher proportion of wounded and convalescing leaders. The ability to order even tactical panzer deployments had been removed from OB West, and sometimes the Generalfeldmarschall felt he only commanded the sentries outside his gate, which reflected the fact that Rundstedt's was a superfluous level of command. Hitler and the Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, OKW, the High Command of the German Armed Forces, based in bunkers at Sossenfundsdorf, 20 miles south of Berlin, could and did bypass him when it suited them. Long past his prime, the aged Field Marshal by 1944 was merely a trusted rubber stamp for the regime. Rundstedt in turn answered to OKW. It is worth noting here that the Wehrmacht comprised the three German armed forces of the Heer, Army, Luftwaffe, Air Force, and Kriegsmarine, Navy, each with their own command chain, but theoretically subordinate to the OKW. The Waffen-SS units, fighting alongside those of the Army, were not even answerable to OKW, but to the Reichsführer-SS Heinrich Himmler, and through him to Hitler. OKW served as the Reich's general staff, but in practice as Hitler's personal military advisers, translating his whims into orders and asserting direct control over army units in the West. This complicated and lengthened military decision-making, resulting in orders issued in Berlin for the deployment of quite small tactical forces, irrespective of local needs and conditions. The head of OKW, Generalfeldmarschall Wilhelm Keitel, was usually to be found at Hitler's side, at the Führerhauptquartiere, the military headquarters codenamed Wolfschanze, Wolf's Lair, at Rastenburg in East Prussia, sometimes at his mountain retreat at Berchtesgaden, and infrequently in Berlin, for Hitler loathed the German capital. The day-to-day running of OKW was left to Keitel's cleverer deputy, Generaloberst Alfred Jodl, technically Chief of Operations Staff. German generals referred to these arrangements privately as Befehlschaos, command by confusion, though it has been observed that the reason for the chaos probably originated in Hitler's very Roman obsession, common with dictators, of keeping significant military and political power away from the hands of potential rivals. By this stage of the war, whatever magic Hitler may once have possessed in the eyes of his senior generals had disappeared. Shakespeare's Macbeth springs to mind. Those he commands move only in command, nothing in love. As Blumentritt, Rundstedt's chief of staff, observed, a dictator does not favour putting too much power in the hands of one man. A month after the 23rd March 1942 British raid on the French port of Saint-Nazaire, Führer Befehl, Führer Directive No. 40, ordered the construction of coastal defences along the fringes of northwest Europe. With the additional distractions of making the Channel Islands impregnable, Hitler assumed their recapture would be a top British priority, constructing bomb-proof facilities for U-boats and building V-weapons sites. The Atlantic Wall programme was not only chaotic, but soon behind schedule. It was born from the military assessments of the Wehrmacht, but it also mirrored Hitler's personal obsession with grand architectural programmes. The pre-war construction of the First Autobahn and Westwall, Siegfried Line, being two prime examples. The aim in 1942 was to defend Europe with modest forces in order to send the majority to Russia. As Hitler stated on 13th August 1942, there is only one battlefront. The others can be held with modest units. He conjured up a figure of 15,000 bunkers to be erected between Norway and Spain, manned by 300,000 troops, with priority given to ports, but only 12,247 would be completed by June 1944. The standard of workmanship varied enormously, with some of the earliest designs already viewed as obsolete by D-Day. This was partly due to a lack of central direction, but in France most of the work was done by local labourers working for subcontractors, often French-owned companies, and many not having the best interests of the Reich in their building efforts. When Hitler discovered the programme was nowhere near his planned completion date of 1 May 1943 for the Atlantic Wall, Rundstedt was ordered to investigate. The head of OB West examined the physical defences, the personnel allocated to man them, and the wider doctrine of defence. He immediately outlined the concerns he had been expressing since 1942, that the troops were few in number, generally of poor quality, and reserves were sparse, because the Russian front took the lion's share of available resources. Rundstedt cited the fact that Berlin had just ordered 20 of his best battalions to pack their bags and redeploy to the Eastern Front, but in exchange gave him 60, recruited from Russian volunteers and prisoners. Led by a smattering of German officers, they may have been capable of internal security and policing, but OB West expected none of them to last more than a few hours in hard combat. Things look black, he stated. It doesn't suffice to build a few pillboxes. One needs defence in depth, he warned on 28th October 1943. The damning report immediately prompted Hitler's Führer Directive No. 51 of 3rd November 1943, which outlined, in near panic, his concerns about the Western defences and the means of strengthening them. It began, "For the last 2.5 years, the bitter and costly struggle against Bolshevism has made the utmost demands upon the bulk of our military resources and energies. This commitment was in keeping with the seriousness of the danger and the overall situation. The situation has since changed. The threat from the East remains, but an even greater danger looms in the West, the Anglo-American landing." The Führer realized that if the enemy here succeeds in penetrating our defences on a wide front, consequences of staggering proportions will follow within a short time. All signs point to an offensive against the Western Front of Europe no later than spring, and perhaps earlier. He went on to state, "I can no longer justify the further weakening of the West in favour of other theatres of war. I have therefore decided to strengthen the defences in the West, particularly at places from which we shall launch our long-range war against England. He was referring here to the future V-weapons program. For those are the very points at which the enemy must and will attack. There, unless all indications are misleading, will be fought the decisive invasion battle. This was the first time Hitler had put serious strategic thought into the implications of the operation the Allies knew as Overlord, prompted by Rundstedt's frightening submission of the previous month. In this document, Hitler set out his thinking and doctrine, which was to dominate the forthcoming campaign until its conclusion. Holding attacks and diversions on other fronts are to be expected. During the opening phase of the battle, the entire striking power of the enemy will, of necessity, be directed against our forces manning the coast. Only an all-out effort in the construction of fortifications, an unsurpassed effort that will enlist all available manpower and physical resources of Germany and the occupied areas, will be able to strengthen our defences along the coasts, within the short time that still appears to be left to us. Should the enemy nevertheless force a landing by concentrating his armed might, he must be hit by the full fury of our counter-attack. The immediate consequence of Rundstedt's report and Führerbefehl No. 51 was an increase in OB West's strength from 46 to 58 divisions. But as Blumentritt observed, Hitler had a predilection for steel, concrete and iron, preferring illusory situation maps 600 miles from reality, which had a calming effect on those with a flair for fantasy. At the end of 1943, with the Africa Corps vanquished, Rommel was kicking his heels in Italy. Not exactly unemployed, he was assessing possible ways of defending northern Italy from Allied attack. He was certainly underemployed, his talent for leading and inspiring men on the battlefield ignored. He had been expecting to command the German 10th and 14th armies in Italy against his old adversary Montgomery, and was already based with a skeleton army group headquarters in a pleasant villa on the shores of Lake Garda in northern Italy. However, he had been outmaneuvered for the job by a rival, Field Marshal Albert Kesselring. Not wishing to waste Rommel's talents, Hitler ordered him instead to assess the strength of the Atlantic Wall, in response to Rundstedt's memorandum that it was a propaganda wall. It was to give his Führer directive some teeth that he sent his best-known marshal, Rommel, as the newly appointed Inspector General of the Western Coast, along with his Army Group Headquarters staff, to review the areas most threatened and report back. The former Africa Corps commander started straight away, visiting Denmark on 1 December. Relations were cordial with OB West. Long past retirement at 69, Rundstedt had been at the helm since March 1942, and although equal in rank to Rommel, there was a difference of 16 years between the pair, pretty much a generation. The Wüstenfuchs had last served under Rundstedt in the French campaign of 1940, when he was a lowly major general. Initially, he shared the collective wisdom that the invasion would fall within the 15th Army's sector, and on 20th December lunched with its commander, Hans von Salmuth, in Tourcoing. This view was also shared by the Navy's Marinegruppenkommando West, which discounted the likelihood of an assault in the Seine Bay because of the complete lack of harbours, apart from the heavily defended Le Havre and Cherbourg, the shallow coastal shelf, tidal variations, and openness to Atlantic storms. Two principal areas in Salmud's sector concerned Rommel, around Calais and the Scheldt estuary leading to the port of Antwerp, which he considered ripe for an airborne assault. In his report to Hitler of 31st December 1943, Rommel reflected the great disparity between the much-photographed 406mm guns of the Batterie Lindemann at Sangatte near Calais, or the impressive bunkers housing four 380mm Krupp weapons of the Batterie Todt at Cap Gris-Nez, with the non-existent beach defences elsewhere. Rommel further bemoaned the fact that the 7th Army possessed over 32 different weapon systems with 252 different types of ammunition, of which 47 types were no longer produced. The entire 7th Army had only 68 88mm and 170 75mm anti-tank guns. The concept of a wall was a complete misnomer. Many so-called strong points consisted only of trenches and sandbags, protected by a few strands of barbed wire. More dummy minefields existed than real ones. There were no measures in place against aerial assault. Countless open sandy beaches lay unguarded, in some cases relying on a pre-existing seawall or anti-tank ditch as their only form of linear defence. The only significant fortifications clustered around ports. In any case, none of the positions possessed any depth. One determined penetration, and the whole network would be overwhelmed. Much of the subsequent debate about Rommel's defensive assets would revolve around tanks. Yet, at the turn of 1943, he was the first to acknowledge what was needed were anti-tank guns, which could debilitate an Allied breakout, firing from camouflaged, fixed positions. His well-sighted 88s had massacred British armour at long ranges in the Western Desert. Tanks, on the other hand, attracted hostile aircraft like flies, and required costly fuel and highly trained crews. Rommel noted, too, the average ages of the defending formations. In Kurt von Schlieben's 709th Division, guarding the Cotentin, it was 36. In the naval batteries encased in thick concrete along the coast, it was 45. He had even encountered gunners aged 56. The true state of the Atlantic Val was worse than Rundstedt's October report had suggested. If an invasion were to arrive within the next few months, Germany was essentially defenceless. Rommel also observed that building programs had actually slowed during the second half of 1943 due to the removal of labourers to other projects, including repairs to bombed dams in the Ruhr. By early 1944, the supply of labour would almost completely dry up as personnel were diverted to repair bomb damage to factories and homes within the Reich, leaving little for the West, which would cause Rommel to direct his troops to build their defences instead of train for battle. The Desert Fox also noted, "The centre of gravity of the enemy landings will probably be the sector held by the 15th Army. It is quite likely that the enemy's main effort will be directed against the sector between Boulogne and the mouth of the Somme, and on either side of Calais, where he will derive maximum advantage from the support of his long-range guns, from the shortest crossing for the assault and later supply operations, and from the best utilization of his air power. His chief objective will almost certainly be to obtain possession as quickly as possible of ports capable of accommodating large numbers of ships." After the war, Heinz Guderian would observe with some glee of the Desert Fox's incorrect predictions. "Rommel assured me several times that the English and American landings would take place in the coastal areas north of the mouth of the Somme." Rommel's views coincided with those of Hitler. In fact, Guderian was playing with history. Every German headquarters had a slightly different view of where the Allies might strike, which altered on an almost monthly basis. General Walter Valimont at OKW recalled his assessment that the Allies would definitely attack in 1944 to assuage Soviet demands, and that an assault on Calais might lead them quickly to Germany's war economy, fixed on the Rhine and Ruhr, without which the Reich would collapse militarily. But they were by no means certain this was what the Allies planned to do. However, Vice Admiral Ruger recalled that later, once Rommel had studied the terrain in more detail, he expected the invasion might arrive in one of three possible areas: the Scheldt, the Somme, and the western part of the Bay of the Seine, where the assault actually took place. At first, Rommel thought that the coast on both sides of the mouth of the Somme the most probable location, because our defences there were especially weak. Later, the Calvados and Cotentin seemed to him most likely, because of Allied air activity in May 1944. He thought, besides the main invasion, there possibly would be minor operations, such as cutting off the northwest part of Brittany by taking Brest, or cutting off the Cotentin or Le Havre. Günter Blumentritt, OB West's chief of staff, nevertheless observed, "Armies under the orders of Rundstedt did not know who was now in charge, Rundstedt or Special Inspector Rommel, which led to friction." The aged Rundstedt had to be reassured by Keitel that he was not being put out to grass and that the erstwhile Wüstenfuchs, a fellow field marshal, would be subordinated to him. After that, things went well, and Rommel, at Rundstedt's suggestion, was offered and accepted leadership of the areas threatened with invasion, effective 15th January 1944. Both Rundstedt and Hitler were aware of the enhanced status within Germany of the former Afrika Korps commander, the Sicherheitsdienst SD, who monitored dissent within the Third Reich, noted that enormous faith was placed in Rommel's ability to turn the tide of the war in the West, both amongst servicemen and civilians, though until then Rommel's brief in the West had been to observe, not command. His future subordinates included Generals Friedrich Dollmann's 7th Army and Salmut's 15th Army, deployed north of the Loire and between Brittany and the Netherlands, and the resultant army group became an intermediate tier of authority under Rundstedt, whose authority was, in fact, undermined. The 7th Army comprised 198,000 men. The 15th was rather better off, with 313,000 men in 18 divisions, garrisons and fortress detachments. Initially, Rommel and his staff were quartered at Fontainebleau, but moved on 9th March to La Roche-Guyon, ancestral home of the Dukes of Rochefoucauld, a thousand-year-old chateau on the Seine, and equidistant between his two formations, whose inter-army boundary was the Dives River. On 1 April 1944, his new chief of staff, Generalleutnant Hans Speidel, arrived, and very soon the Desert Fox came to rely on the bright, bespectacled and crafty soldier-scholar. He had gained a PhD before the war, who ran his headquarters like clockwork. The two chiefs of staff, Blumentritt at OB West and Speidel at Army Group B, had known one another since 1920 and worked harmoniously together, according to the former, who also described Speidel as very shrewd, who had a natural understanding of how to gloss over friction. Rommel was remarkably ignorant of the logistics required to run his campaigns. In April 1941, the army had been obliged to send its quartermaster general, the then little-known Friedrich Paulus, to the Western Desert, to remind the errant Afrika Korps commander of some fundamental principles of logistics for sustained operations. Speidel would have to do the same in the coming months. Rommel, for example, had never led formations equipped with large numbers of horses, of which the 7th Army had 43,000 and the 15th 33,000. Rundstedt's own command, OB West, was eventually subdivided into two army groups, Rommel's Heeresgruppe B and Army Group G, created on 26th April under Generaloberst Johannes Blaskowitz, covering terrain south of the Loire. The 1st and 19th armies of Army Group G covered the Biscay coast and the Riviera with 17 divisions. Yet German doctrine and experience of the Eastern Front, the Desert Fox had uniquely never served in Russia, would provoke a tactical rift between Rommel and Rundstedt. The former wished to repel the Allies as they landed, when they were most vulnerable, disorganized, wet, cold, seasick and disorientated. North Africa had taught him the damage Allied air interdiction could do to reinforcements moving into the combat zone. Therefore, the closer his reserves were to the main effort, the better. As Rommel correctly predicted to Helmut Lang in April, "The war will be won or lost here on the beach. We have only one possibility, to bring the enemy to a stop. We must get him as long as he is in the water and is fighting to get to land. Reinforcement troops will never be able to get to the battle. It is foolish to even count on this." Rundstedt, who had not witnessed Allied close air support at work in 1942-3, believed that it would be impossible to defend the coast for long, if at all, and that any positions should act merely as a tripwire while mobile reserves were husbanded, concentrated, and unleashed. The older man knew the Atlantic Wall could never be a physical, continuous obstruction. The most it could do would be to canalize opponents onto ground of the Germans' choosing, or by time, as the obstacle belt was demolished and crossed, for reinforcements to be rushed to the correct spot. Then, as many panzer divisions as could be assembled, should counterattack. This was precisely the response to the Sicilian landings of July 1943, when a counterattack by a battle group from the Hermann Göring panzer division nearly threw the US landings at Gela back into the sea. 2 months later at Salerno, and in January 1944 at Anzio, the scenario repeated itself, where powerful Kampfgruppen, including panzers, struck at the invaders. In each case, the attackers prevailed due to naval gunfire support. But to Rundstedt's mind, the concept seemed proven, especially if the Allies could be enticed a little inland, beyond the range of their warships' guns. Yet in Berlin, Rundstedt was aware the very name Atlantikwall conjured up images of solid castle walls, with the same sort of mythical, impregnable status the Maginot Line had represented for the French in 1940. Some commanders, like Generalleutnant Josef Reichert of the 711th Infantry Division in Salmut's 15th Army, refused to believe the Allies were planning an invasion at all. In his mind, it was all a huge bluff to help the Soviets by fixing all the Wehrmacht's reserves in the west. That is, until two British paratroopers arrived literally on his front lawn in the early hours of 6th June. To oversee the collective training and deployment of OB West's 10 armoured divisions and direct them in battle, Hitler created Panzergruppe West, later renamed the 5th Panzer Army, under Freiherr Baron Geyer von Schweppenburg, which was placed under Rundstedt on 24th January, and was arguably the only organisation with the ability to destroy an Allied beachhead. Its headquarters were stationed near Paris, partly because of anxieties about an Allied airborne descent onto the city, and partly because the capital was the handle of the fan, equidistant from any threatened area. However, the existence of Panzergruppe West made no sense. No other nation's forces put their armoured formations under separate control. Usual practice across the world was for tank formations to operate to the same command chain as infantry units. The panzer divisions were the Wehrmacht's elite, and there were frequent squabbles within the German hierarchy as to who should control them. Heinz Guderian, architect of the panzer arm and inspector general of armoured troops, was adamant they remain under army control. Geyer, therefore, was Guderian's watchman in the west, keeping the tanks out of the clutches of Himmler and Göring, though there was a Luftwaffe panzer division fighting in Italy. Geyer utilized many of the staff from Panzergruppe Africa, dissolved the previous year, and was charged with training and deploying all panzer units in the west, including those of the Waffen-SS. As one of the architects of the May 1940 victory over the French and virtual guru of tank soldiers, Guderian exerted much influence in Berlin, but was a meddler. Forthright, he frequently fell out with colleagues, and Hitler. He acknowledged Rommel was not only an open, upright man and a brave soldier, he was also a highly gifted commander, possessed energy and subtlety of appreciation. He always found an answer to the most difficult of problems, and had a great understanding of his men. Yet Guderian backed Geyer and disagreed with Rommel over the positioning of panzers in the west, and continued to defend his views long after the war. Specifically, the Guderian-Geyer lobby were anxious that the panzer divisions were to be committed as units and not piecemeal by companies and regiments. In the event, however, the exact reverse took place. Geyer noted that the armchair strategy of Berchtesgaden and Rommel's lack of strategic training resulted in the panzer divisions being frittered away in piecemeal operations of a minor and defensive nature. Guderian felt all the panzer and panzer grenadier divisions should be concentrated ready in two groups, one north and the other south of Paris. The mention of the French capital is significant, for all the German hierarchy believed part of the Allied plan would involve marching on Paris, which was not the case, enabled by a mass airborne assault, as noted earlier. This explains the positioning of many German mobile formations, which were to meet two threats. They were stationed along main roads that would lead them either to the invasion front, wherever it might be, or to defend Paris, for lightly armed paratroops would have little defence against tanks. Other units, too, lingered in northern Belgium, reflecting concerns that the Allies might try to seize the vital port of Antwerp from the air, a concept also encouraged by the Canadian Army as part of the Allied deception. Based near Paris, Geyer seemingly trained his command well. His ideas have a very modern ring to them. There were night exercises 3 times a week, and extensive studies and experiments in hedgerow fighting, with demonstration battalions schooled in British doctrine engaging in simulated combat against German units. Once a week was Fliegertag, aviation day, set aside for training against air attack. Yet both Geyer and Rundstedt were demonstrably out of date. Neither had appreciated the extent of Allied air superiority by 1944, or the ability of close air support to interdict troops and tanks moving forward to the combat zone. The Soviets had not yet developed this capability when either had last served in the East. As Gunther Blumentritt recalled of a conversation with Rommel in February 1944, he had got to know the modus operandi of the British Air Force in North Africa, and was convinced that in this situation panzer divisions could not in any case be moved, either by day or by night, because they would immediately be attacked from the air. Fritz Bayerlein, former chief of staff to Rommel in Africa, recollected a similar conversation from this time. "It's not a matter of fanatical hordes to be driven forward in masses against our line, with no regard for casualties and little recourse to tactical craft. Here we are facing an enemy who applies all his native intelligence to the use of his many technical resources, who spares no expenditure of material, and whose every operation goes its course, as though it had been the subject of repeated rehearsal. Dash and doggedness alone no longer make a soldier." Although Rommel and Rundstedt disagreed over the placement of the panzers, the two field marshals appear to have got on quite well. The acrimony over tanks was centred on Rommel and Geyer. The pair were talented trainers and leaders of men who understood their enemy, but were headstrong and worked against one another. Eventually, Rundstedt and Hitler grew tired of the endless Panzer-Kontroverse bickering between Rommel, Guderian and Geyer. And when, on 26th April, Hitler announced the formation of Army Group G to oversee the 1st and 19th Armies in southern France, effective on 12th May, he attached to Army Group G three of Geyer's panzer divisions, the 9th, 11th and 2nd SS. At the same time, three were put under Rommel's tactical control, 2nd, 21st and 116th panzer divisions, leaving the remaining four in the west, 3 SS, the 1st, 12th and 17th, and Fritz Bayerlein's Panzerlehr, under Geyer as a strategic reserve. The 17th SS possessed no tanks at all, just a battalion of assault guns, and was, in fact, designated a Panzergrenadier division. This was a point of detail missed by Allied intelligence prior to Overlord. The crucial rider was that any deployment of the panzers was to be cleared with Berlin first, which overrode all German military doctrine and logic. This assignment of panzer divisions in France was as much a compromise by Hitler to assuage the demands of Rommel, Geyer and Rundstedt as it was an attempt to anticipate where the Allies would land. Apart from suiting no one, the sad reality was that the Panzergruppe West was an extra layer to an already overcomplicated command structure and ensured that any response to an invasion was bound to be slow and interrupted by petty jealousies. In combat, the normal groupings of all panzer divisions disappeared, for instead they had learned to form all-arms Kampfgruppen, battle groups, at battalion and regimental level. These comprised a variable blend of tanks, armoured infantry, artillery, anti-tank gunners, engineers, and logistical support. Battle groups took the name of the senior commander present, and were very much a hallmark of the successful German defensive battles throughout the campaign. Another key ingredient of German success on the battlefield was the concept of giving a local commander freedom to act as he thought best. The idea was to give a leader his mission or goal, but leave him to decide how best to carry it out. It encouraged momentum. Known as Auftragstaktik, it has been translated in modern military terminology as mission command. The opposite, which often seemed to characterize much British activity, entailed lengthy orders which included every aspect of a mission, from its aim to how many hand grenades each man was to carry, and in which pocket a field dressing was to be found. Auftragstaktik appears to have been drummed into every senior and junior commander. for it is assumed to be behind the early German triumphs of 1939-42. Even the defensive achievements in Sicily, Salerno, Monte Cassino, and Anzio of 1943-4 have been put down to these broad principles. But we must be wary of attributing too much to doctrinal success. By 1944, Hitler was micromanaging his forces more and more, and commanders at every level were nervous of appearing to contradict the wishes of OKW, the Nazi Party, or Der Führer himself. In a post-war memoir, Geyer von Schweppenburg called the previous era of freedom of initiative the pre-corporal days, that is, before Hitler and his cronies began to conduct the war with complete disregard of the trained military experts. Geyer went on to note, "We would not have been unduly worried by the situation in the front line becoming apparently critical. We should have waited unperturbed until all the reserve divisions involved had assembled, and should then have launched them in a counterblow against the enemy. Under the regime now in vogue, however, this method was not possible. Neither Hitler nor Supreme Command West understood, nor had the courage, to let panzer situations ripen. Thus, the very initiative that had created success in the early years began to ebb, partly through fear, partly because the National Socialist regime encouraged it to wane. Auftrag's Taktik was out, at least in name." In a telling 2014 interview with the Fallschirmjäger trooper Johannes Burner, who fought in Normandy, when asked what he knew of Auftrag's Taktik, replied, "That doesn't tell me anything. I don't know it." In the summer of 1944, there were three factors that Wehrmacht doctrine had not taken into account. Two were linked: the crushing might of Allied air power, to which the Germans had no answer, and the Materialschlacht, battle of equipment, that flowed out of American factories, dwarfing the quantities, and eventually the quality, of anything the Third Reich could produce. The third factor was homegrown, the illogical, bullying interference of Adolf Hitler. One of the Führer's many diktats from Russia followed his troops to Normandy, that each position should be held to the last round, the last man. Retreat was verboten, forbidden. The Seventh Army very sensibly asked Rommel if men from one coastal strong point came to the aid of another, would they be in violation of Hitler's order? Such a conundrum would have stymied most commanders, but not Rommel. A few days later, a Rommelbefehl decreed, within divisional areas, the tactical movement of subordinate units would be at the discretion of field commanders. Furthermore, the movement of divisions would require Rommel's authority, not Hitler's. The Desert Fox, used to being his own boss, also had to overcome the mindset of the occupation forces in France. One of his subordinate commanders, General von Schlieben, arrived in December 1943 to find that, for someone who had served only in the East, the flood of orders, directives, and regulations which continually showered the troops was a novelty for me. This paper flood impressed me more than the tide along the Atlantic coast. Higher headquarters concerned themselves with trivial affairs of subordinate commanders. For example, it became a problem whether a machine gun was to be placed 20 meters more to the right or the left, which neatly illustrated how the spirit of Auftrag's Taktik had mostly been abandoned by the Wehrmacht by 1944. The defenders of Normandy used a wide range of captured small arms, much of it Czech, Polish, and Russian, as well as French and Belgian, all of which became a procurement nightmare for the Wehrmacht's quartermasters, who were routinely expected to furnish ammunition and spare parts for at least a dozen different rifles and machine guns. While the German arsenal in France ensured that everyone had a weapon, this was achieved at the expense of uniformity, but there was never enough of anything to turn the tide of the campaign. As Lieutenant Hans Heinz with the 916th Grenadier Regiment of the 352nd Division reported, "A large percentage of machine guns in our bunkers were captured weapons that did not fit our standard ammunition." It was a similar story with the Panzer Arm. By 1944, the Germans were fielding at least four kinds of main battle tank, plus the tracked turretless Sturmgeschütz, Stöge, assault gun, an endless variety of tank destroyers and self-propelled guns, usually of 75mm caliber, based on outmoded German tank hulls, and those from captured nations, eight-wheeled armoured cars, and anti-tank weapons mounted in half-tracks. To the tired, nervous Allied soldier in his foxhole, these were all panzers, or in the terminology of the day, hornets. British, American, and Canadian planners in 1944 made comparisons with their own armoured units, mostly based on Sherman's, though a few on Churchill's or Cromwell's, where everything was standardised, there was commonality of spare parts and uniformity of replacement, like for like, supplied immediately. Yet what the Allies failed to appreciate was that there was no such thing as a standard panzer division. The Germans had a theoretical template, long since disregarded. The June 1944 reality was that no two panzer formations were the same. To state that weapon for weapon, tank for tank, even in 1944, its equipment decisively outclassed that of the Allies in every category save artillery and transport, as some historians have claimed, is to skate over the truth of the Wehrmacht in 1944. Although the Allies, wrongly, assumed the Germans were awash with Tiger tanks and MG-42 machine guns, the truth was more mundane. Most of its soldiers had lost any commitment to the war they might have possessed in 1940, and very few believed in final victory. They just wanted to go home. The Germans had some excellent designs, but a bomb-ravaged manufacturing base. They often had an adequate, but never generous, supply of ammunition, but little means of moving it quickly to where it needed to be, while Allied air power endangered every daylight move they made. A cross-channel invasion would be not unlike a First World War battle, thought Rommel. The channel was a wide obstacle, an equivalent of no man's land, to be traversed before an assault on his trenches. He placed a premium on laying minefields and beach obstacles, from his experience of trying to penetrate the British Gazala line in Libya. From 1941 to October 1943, O.B. West had overseen the laying of 1,992,895 anti-tank and anti-personnel mines. By May 1944, with Rommel's energy, this figure had increased to 6,508,330, with 517,000 foreshore obstacles strewn in three rows between the high and low water marks. Some 31,000 of them were fitted with mines, but Rommel wanted double this, in six rows along every threatened beach. Inland, 2-metre-high stakes, sharpened at the end, were placed on likely glider and parachute drop zones to destroy aircraft and impale paratroopers. These all amounted to a recreation of the barbed wire entanglements of the Western Front, so well known to the 1914-18 generation. Yet these figures fell woefully short of Rommel's estimated need of 50 million mines. Blumentritt, Rundstedt's chief of staff, remembered, Rommel did not smoke and ate and drank but little. No landscape, no historic building interested him. He was just a soldier. During a meal he would often take his pencil and a sheet of paper and sketch some new technical idea. Then he would hand it to his engineer general, with the request that he would give his views on it the next morning before starting out. If he relaxed at all, he read Wild West novels by Carl May and detective stories, recommended to him by Hitler. Rommel was an excellent illustrator, and once stated if he had not been a soldier, he would like to have been an artist. Blumentritt continued, engineers, artillerymen, and sailors were for the most part pressed into service as attendants, and Rommel was always requiring new proposals from them. Not unlike Montgomery, he went to bed very early in order to be able to start off fresh again in the morning. As a rule, he had one or two keepers of war records with him, who took photographs on every possible occasion. Rommel's technical solutions included steel girders welded together, hedgehogs, and simple wooden stakes embedded in the sand with mines attached to detonate on contact with seaborne assault craft. Collectively, these were known as the Rommelbelt, or Rommelspargel, Rommel's asparagus. His sketches of obstacles made the beaches look like vegetable gardens. The Desert Fox also arrived at some of the same concepts of deception as the Allies to mask his true strength, as Vice Admiral Ruger recorded on 11th May. subordinated units received orders to quickly construct mock tanks in order to simulate fast mobile units and, as with dummy batteries, divert the enemy. This order arrived too late to affect the invasion, but might have had an impact had the Allies attacked later. Beyond the various obstacles were reinforced concrete structures which served many purposes: housing munitions, air defences, communications, headquarters staff, artillery observation and fire direction, searchlights, power generators, and personnel. Even unfinished, it was an enormous construction effort, with around 5,000 bunkers completed by December 1942 and 8,000 by the following June. Between 1942 and 1944, they consumed 1.3 million tons of steel for reinforcing rods, doors, and cupolas, around 5% of the Reich's total output in those 2 years, in addition to 17.3 million cubic yards of concrete. By comparison, the six-year project to tunnel under the English Channel, completed in 1994, used 1.7 million cubic yards, exactly one-tenth of the concrete poured into the Atlantic Wall. The hard core of these defences was its coastal gun batteries, with 343 built along the French coast, housing 1,348 guns of 150mm calibre or greater. Each site comprised multiple bunkers housing the guns, ammunition, personnel quarters and local defences. All were surrounded by minefields. The larger gun sites incorporated small rail networks to convey ammunition from storage bunkers to the main cannon. Their assembled weaponry comprised Czech, French, British and Russian cannon captured during the victory years. In Zalmutt's 15th Army sector, some 495 separate artillery casemates and other emplacements had been constructed by June 1944, while Dolman's 7th Army area contained around 200, with a further 75 erected in the 1st Army's area, overlooking the Bay of Biscay. In 1942, Rundstedt had rationalised the hierarchy of his coastal defences, ranging from festungen, fortresses, accommodating large guns placed in reinforced concrete structures via Verteidigungsbereiche, defence sectors, down to Stützpunktgruppen, strongpoint groups, comprising an individual Stützpunkt, strongpoint, or Widerstandsnest, resistance nest. All were designed to be self-sufficient enough to hold out for up to a week, though in the event, none would manage more than a day. There were some 250 basic types of bunker, of which the most common was the Tobruk, named after a pattern first employed in Libya. Essentially, a small concrete box with a circular hole from which a two-man machine gun crew could emerge. Hundreds of these Tobruks still litter the beaches of Normandy and Brittany, which 75 years' worth of winter storms have generally filled with sand. Other Tobruks housed light mortars or incorporated small tank turrets, taken from obsolete French or German panzers, whose guns added to the firepower. These are not evident today, as post-war scrap metal dealers quickly stripped the Atlantic Wall of all its steel fittings. Yet the time, resources, and manpower required to build even one small Tobruk were in short supply. For example, a standard six-man bunker with room for ammunition required 650 cubic yards of concrete, 25 tons of steel reinforcing rods, and another 6 tons of steel for protective doors, embrasures, and ventilation shafts. In preparation, just as the Allies would do in southern England, Rommel had some of the coastal regions of Army Group B evacuated, along with villages along the Caen Canal. At Bénouville, a café where Grenadiers Wilhelm Fertner, Erwin Sauer and Helmut Römer relaxed while guarding an important bridge, was one of the few properties left inhabited for the service it provided to his soldiers. The Allies were aware that from June 1943, the Germans had encouraged the removal of the population from the Channel coast and nearby inland towns, to allow the defenders to prepare their positions, though essential civilians, such as doctors, teachers, farmers, local officials, priests and policemen, and anyone who served the Wehrmacht, such as restaurateurs and shopkeepers, were allowed to remain. Ouistreham and Aromanche were partly emptied by order, and in May 1944, clearly anticipating trouble, the local prefect of the département, appealed for all children to be removed from the coast between Grand-Caen and Ouistreham. By June, thousands had left Caen, Cabourg, Bayeux and Deauville and moved inland. All this suited Rommel, for the combined population of the Caen-Bayeux arrondissement, administrative districts, alone was around 250,000, for whom he had no wish to be responsible should the fighting come to Normandy. It was Rommel's idea, too, to flood low-lying areas behind the Seventh Army's coast, turning them into inaccessible marsh, which would see the demise of hundreds of paratroopers on D-Day. Blumentritt recalled that Rommel also intended to flood wide stretches of land behind the 15th Army, but, out of consideration for the French population, Rundstedt rejected the idea, which doesn't accord with the usual sympathetic portrayal of the Desert Fox. Building the fixed defensive positions was challenging. A never-ending series of missives from Berlin ordered that all bunkers had to be capable of self-defense, possess their own independent water supply, a kitchen, latrines, an electricity dynamo, be gas-proof, and be able to communicate with other bunkers by armoured field telephone wire. Much was robbed from the Maginot Line and other inland fortress systems, even the Siegfried Line, but as we have observed, the Atlantikwall project was still well short of Hitler's aspirations for it by June 1944. As Oberstleutnant Fritz Ziegelmann, chief of staff of the 352nd Division, noted, almost half of the battle installations were outmoded. In our division's sector alone, analysis showed that only 15% of the cement fortifications were bomb-resistant and 45% were shrapnel-proof. The availability of cement and dealing with four independent construction authorities were decisive issues. He observed of the inter-service rivalry, Rommel's authority was not enough. Luftwaffe workers, Kriegsmarine, Organisation Todt, the prime construction contractor, and our own fortress engineers worked side by side, often duplicating work. The Air Force built concrete positions while our infantry, with their heavy weapons, were in poor earth emplacements prone to flooding. Slave labourers of the Third Reich's Organisation Todt, OT, named after its founder, Fritz Todt, an engineer and senior Nazi figure, were responsible for contract construction. Some French workers measured what they built and trickled the information back to London. Others surreptitiously added tiny amounts of sugar to the wet concrete mix, which would fatally weaken its ability to withstand bombardment. Blumentritt recorded that Rommel, determined to requisition the French male population to build the Atlantikwall, and let it be known he would provide meals and wages if volunteers reported for this work. They did so, and thus presented the remarkable picture of German troops and French civilians working together with great zeal, a bizarre notion, as far removed from popular French memory as it is possible to be. Many labourers were also drafted in from the Netherlands, Belgium, Russia and Italy, which had changed sides in 1943. They received poor rations, minimal healthcare, and their lives were considered cheap. In the rush to get the defences built, eventually Wehrmacht troops, too, were obliged to roll up their sleeves. At the beginning of 1944, on Rommel's orders, most military training ground to a halt, as all troops became involved in erecting beach defences, siting mines, and uncoiling miles of barbed wire. After the war, Geyer thought the time and numerical strength of the troops was wasted on the construction of fortifications at the expense of training. It still comes as a surprise to many that the German army in Normandy was predominantly horse-drawn. When Second Lieutenant Bob Sheehan of the U.S. 60th Chemical Company, an outfit responsible for smoke weapons, breasted a rise over the dunes of Omaha on 7th June, he saw a mind-shattering sight that convinced me the war was as good as won. It was a dead horse. The poor animal was still attached to the wagon it had been pulling. The wagon was a German army one, and covered with military symbols. Scattered around it lay the artillery shells it had been carrying. The mighty Wehrmacht, the inventors of the Blitzkrieg, had been reduced to using ancient, slow, fragile horses and carts to exist. We have already noted that 115,000 of them were assigned to O.B. West, with exactly 33,739 on the books of the 7th Army on 1st March 1944, and another 10,000 arriving by 1st June. These numbers came as a shock to Rommel, who, of course, had commanded the 7th Panzer Division in 1940 and the Africa Corps in 1941-3, neither of which used horses. Wehrmacht reductions in the number of artillery pieces and soldiers assigned to infantry divisions in France saw further cutbacks in their transport. By 1944, such formations averaged 3,100 horses and 370 trucks each, even though even these figures were rarely achieved. Of note is that the supposedly modern, mechanized Wehrmacht received 158,900 horse wagons in 1943 and 190,700 in 1944. Generally of wooden construction with four-spoked wheels and a canvas tarpaulin supported on beech or ash hoops, they perpetuated the Wehrmacht's reliance on 19th-century wagon trains and would not have looked out of place in a Wild West movie. Unterveterinär Dr. Reinhard Schwarz was one of the 7th Army's veterinary surgeons in Normandy. He was drafted into the German Veterinary Corps in 1941, being posted to Normandy in the autumn of 1943. He had to keep an eye on the horses of Richter's 716th, Kreiss's 352nd, and Schlieben's 709th divisions along the invasion coast. Once in Calvados, Schwarz recalled, he was summoned to the aid of some Wehrmacht artillerymen who were struggling to pull their guns along a rutted, muddy country lane with commandeered cattle, and was struck by the similarity of the scene to an image of the Thirty Years' War. For its needs in Poland, France, and Russia, the Wehrmacht had impounded many civilian trucks from within Germany and conquered lands, but they foresaw they would not be able to sustain them, and indeed, most vehicle attrition in those campaigns was due to wear and tear, not combat. A close look at photographs and newsreels of Wehrmacht vehicles in Normandy reveals a huge variety of manufacturers, Fiats from Italy, French Peugeots, Renaults and Citroëns, captured Fords and Bedfords from Britain, alongside Czech Tatras and Skodas, plus German VWs, Mercedes and Opels. Here was the nub of the Wehrmacht's motor transport problem. Lack of spare parts meant it simply could not maintain such a varied vehicle fleet. Hitler's economists similarly foresaw that shortages of oil, imported from Mexico and Russia before the war and Romania during it, or synthesized from domestic coal supplies, would not be easily overcome. The Wehrmacht tried to adapt its vehicles to run on wood gas, but on 29 May 1944, Army Group B's quartermaster observed that only 3,552 out of the truck fleet of 14,578 had been converted. Rubber for tyres and other components was also in great shortage, a commodity Britain, via the Empire and the US, had in relative abundance. Thus, the conscious German Army decision, even in pre-war plans dating back to 1936, to shy away from the internal combustion engine and rely more on horses. Franco-German relations were a sore point during the occupation and have understandably remained a touchy issue since. As Obergefreiter Josef Brass with the 352nd Division observed, for the most part, the French people were amiable towards us. Some hated us and were probably in the Maquis, others supported us, the collaborators, but most were just concerned with getting on with everyday life. Oberleutnant Gustav Flachsch, with the 716th Infantry Division and second in command of Strongpoint WN-28 on Juno Beach, had only fond memories of his time in the area. Saint-Aubin was a happy place for us. The soldiers were young people. They had their girlfriends and made music in private houses. They danced and they drank. Feldwebel Karl Schick agreed. He had been posted from Paris, with some reluctance, to the 2nd Battalion of the 736th Grenadier Regiment at Tailleville, a mile inland from Saint-Aubin. His job as a master tailor brought him into frequent contact with the local population. I was responsible for shopping and went to our neighbours, the Cassignol and asked if they would be able to help us out in any way with various kinds of foodstuffs. I bought milk at their farm, for example, and out of this there developed a friendly relationship. Rémy Cassignol, then 19, who had been requisitioned to plant anti-landing obstacles in the fields between Saint-Aubin and Tailleville, remembered the relationship and thought our Germans were fine. We had no problems at all. Many of them were farmers, and we were all the same age, and traded information about farming methods. His wife, Marguerite, recollected. There were two soldiers staying with us. They left in the morning, returned in the late afternoon, but my father told us that we should not say anything to them. However, there was the ugly side of collaboration, as Feldwebel Eugen Grieser, with No. 5 Company of Major Friedrich von der Heiter's 6th Fallschirmjäger Regiment, highly trained paratroopers all, recalled when going to visit a friendly farmer who had given them some freshly slaughtered rabbits. We went to pay him a visit and offer our collective tobacco rations in thanks. We found him lying in his living room with a crushed-in skull. His wife and children had disappeared. Someone, probably his murderers, had drawn the sign for the resistance in charcoal on the wall. The Wehrmacht's older female hosts soon became surrogate mothers, cooking and mending the clothes of the lonely young men, who promptly fell in love with their daughters. Sometimes the relationships were of a more commercial nature, collaboration horizontale, as it was called, whether paid or unpaid. Yet many young Germans chose not to see France in terms of available young women. As the youthful grenadier Heinrich Böll wrote home to his parents, "France is beautiful, full of humanity and sweetness, full of beautiful towns and villages and pleasant people who are truly human. That's why it's all the harder to be a soldier here, totally excluded from this life." The invasion caught the 7th Army's Generaloberst Friedrich Dollmann by surprise. He was out of his depth, but those in the know understood he was a figurehead, and that the 7th was really run by its chief of staff, the very able Generalmajor Max Pemsel. Based in Le Mans, Dollmann had taken over the 7th Army in 1939, and with them had served on occupation duties in northern France since 1940. He was happy with his lot, fluent in French, not over-anxious to serve in Russia, but had little experience of modern war and no understanding of armour, and made no effort to understand new techniques and weapon systems. The avuncular, pipe-smoking, almost casual Dollmann, renowned for slapping his subordinates on the back to put them at ease, was noticeably older than most of his fellows, 62 at the time of the invasion. He happened to be stationed in Munich, the cradle of Nazism, continuously from 1923 to 33, and thus saw the way the political wind was blowing. He had kept in private contact with the rising National Socialist movement and joined the Nazis, illegally, as officers were supposed to be non-political, which advanced his career after Hitler came to power. Dollmann typified the old guard, with little or no combat experience, a love of the bottle, and an aversion to discomfort. When Lieutenant Raimund Steiner, a newly commissioned officer recovering from wounds in Russia, reported for duty in Caen on Christmas Day in 1943, he immediately found himself ill at ease with the overtly relaxed lifestyle of the German occupation there. Posted to a gun battery behind Sword Beach, on arrival he found some of his fellow officers drunk, and French civilians seemingly doing all the administration. I was bewildered and unhappy about this. For me, such a reception after my Eastern Front experiences was unbelievable, so much so that I contemplated going back to my old mountain artillery unit. As Oberleutnant Haider of the 716th Division's artillery observed, there was always a certain discord between the original veterans of the 1940 France campaign and the incoming recently wounded from the Russian front hospitals. Many of us suffered withdrawal symptoms, which we did not or could not communicate. As we have seen, over 1942-3, the 7th Army lost its best troops to the Eastern Front, who were replaced by less fit, older conscripts, Volksdeutsche, ethnic Germans from the occupied East, and Ostgruppen, Eastern European volunteers, the latter comprising 23 battalions, or about 17% of Dollmann's infantry. Given his lamentable lack of combat experience, Dolman was the worst possible choice anyone could have made for senior command on a potential invasion coast. He shoulders the blame for the Seventh Army's lack of training, poor defences, and hopeless reaction to D-Day. A Seventh Army, with almost anyone else at its helm, would have given the Allies a much harder fight on 6th June. On 9th May 1944, Rommel drove to the Cotentin Peninsula, which seems to become the focal point of the invasion. He visited the local corps commander, General Erich Marx, in his headquarters at Saint-Lô, where he received briefings from him and Generalleutnant Edgar Feuchtinger of the 21st Panzer Division, and requested from him a precise reconnaissance of all roads suitable for troop transport and of all readiness areas for a combat group on the Cotentin. Feuchtinger figured 4 hours from Caen to Cherbourg for wheeled units and 24 hours for tracked units. Using his military antenna, Rommel had thus anticipated some of the precise Allied plans and planned to move extra forces closer to the Cherbourg area. Erich Marx, leading the 84th Corps, would have been a different proposition commanding the 7th Army. In fact, he had been suggested as a possible commander of it by Rommel, replacing the indolent Dolman. But as Marx was of independent mind and antipathetic to the Nazi Party, Hitler preferred to keep Dolman, a proven Nazi, in place, to the 7th Army's detriment. As it was, Marx's 84th Corps was responsible for what would become the invasion coast. He also happened to agree with Rommel's forward defence proposals. Acknowledged to possess one of the finest minds in the German army, the austere, bespectacled, and energetic Marx had helped plan Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of Russia in 1941, but had lost a leg subsequently leading troops there. On recovery, he posted to command the 84th Corps, housed in a bunker complex located in the centre of Saint-Lô. Russia may have robbed him of a limb, but combat in Normandy would cost him his life, and a similar terminal fate awaited 4 of his 7 divisional commanders. Marx's other formations included Generalleutnant Heinz Helmich's 243rd Division, headquartered at Barneville on the Cotentin's west coast. Originally a static unit, it had been gradually upgrading its weaponry and mobility, and included 18-year-old Jürgen Horst, who served in No. 3 Company of Oberstleutnant Franz Müller's 922nd Grenadier Regiment. He wrote home, "Our Russian shoe mender is excellent and has expertly repaired my marching boots. However, we all have bicycles to get about the countryside. Parents, do not concern yourselves about me, for we have good rations here from the local farmers. We eat better than in the Reich." After 6th June, Erich Marx would also command the 77th Division around the old port of St. Malo, and a final unit, Rudolf Graf Count von Schmettow's 319th Division in the Channel Islands. The latter would take no part in the battle for Normandy, and its 300 bunkers housing long-range cannon of up to 305mm, 12-inch calibre, several miles of concrete anti-tank walls, and vast arsenal of equipment and impressive manpower would be left to fester until the island's liberation on 9th May 1945. Some Landseer had been stationed there so long that they joked they would soon receive cuff titles embroidered with the text "The König eigener deutsche Grenadiere," King's Own German Grenadiers. Major Hübner, Schmettow's chief of staff, noted his division was the largest in the German army on 6th June 1944, with over 26,000 very well-armed men under command, which might have tipped the balance in repelling the Allied assault. Erich Marx had arranged to drive to Rennes at 0500 hours on Tuesday 6th June. He was hosting war games in the city, 3 hours distant, the old Prussian concept of the Kriegsspiel, war game, being a proven method of trying out tactics and military ideas, and still used today. These followed on from an earlier Kriegsspiel held in Rundstedt's headquarters at Saint-Germain-en-Laye in the western suburbs of Paris. This was in February, and Marx had assumed the role of attacker. Back then, following landings on the north coast of the Cotentin, Marx had occupied Normandy and Brittany, annihilating the 7th Army. he had immediately warned Rundstedt and Rommel, without mincing matters, that he could carry out neither defence nor even a delaying action on the coast with his meagre forces. Marx stated he had emplacements without guns, ammunition depots without ammunition, minefields without mines, and a large number of men in uniform, with hardly a soldier among them. In Rennes, on 6th June, he again anticipated playing the role of Eisenhower invading Normandy, and hoped the defenders would do better. This time the theme would be different. Marx had asked one of his fellow corps commanders, Fallschirmjäger Eugen Meindl, a veteran of Norway, Crete, and Russia, who led the two parachute divisions stationed in Brittany, to frame the exercise around airborne landings in northern France. A nightmare scenario, although they couldn't know the Allies had vastly insufficient capacity to transport all their paratroopers. But where might they land? We have seen that Antwerp, Paris, and the Cotentin Peninsula were the obvious worries, and the latter two would be the objects of Marx's Kriegsspiel. But, alas, Erich Marx's zeal worked against him, for the Rennes war games would ensure that many key division commanders and staff officers would be absent from their headquarters during the initial hours of 6th June. On 4th May, Rommel had requested from OKW the transfer of the Panzer Lehr division from Le Mans to Bayeux, the move of the 12th SS Panzer from Lisieux to Carentan, with Generalmajor Paul Tschokel's 7th Werfer-Brigade, 100 or 6 battalions of multi-barreled Nebelwerfer mortars, towed or mounted on half-tracks, moved from Beauvais to the southern Cotentin. With the 21st Panzer Division close to Caen, he would have three armoured formations ranged along the Calvados coast, and the area bristling with guns. However, the Inspector General of Armour, Guderian, managed to stymie any movement of armour and the mortar formation closer to the Normandy coast. But on 26th May, General Wolfgang Pickett himself arrived at La Roche-Guyon with the welcome news that he was now under Rommel's command. The Desert Fox had first noticed Pickett's powerful 3rd Flak Corps of anti-aircraft artillery on his arrival in France. With 12,000 personnel, it was fully mobile and comprised around 188mm dual-purpose anti-aircraft anti-tank cannon and 300 smaller-caliber weapons, scattered throughout France defending airfields and V-weapon sites. Once familiar with the terrain and searching for troops and weapons with which to defend it, Rommel started to lobby Göring and OKW to release the Flak Corps to him, for he wanted it to accompany his panzer divisions as they charged for the coast. Its high mobility could open a corridor, and keep it open under attack from the dreaded Jabos, Jagdbomber, Allied fighter bombers, as his tanks thundered through. Rommel, alone of most commanders in the West, knew what it was like to be under aerial assault from the Allies. Three of Pickett's flak regiments would be committed to both sides of the Somme, while the fourth was assigned to the Bayeux-Isigny area. As soon as the invasion was announced, Pickett assured Rommel the entire flak corps would be on the road to the threatened area with all haste. No sanction from Berlin would be required. Yet, as Pickett observed, the men were inexperienced in combat and had grown soft in the West. As a veteran commander from the Eastern Front, Pickett immediately started to train and harden them in the arts of reconnaissance, camouflage, digging in, and gunnery against an aerial enemy, under ever-changing conditions. As Pickett remembered immediately after the war, the officers were young, fresh, and select, but had only little combat experience and no knowledge of cooperation with ground forces. In less than 2 weeks, his arrangements would be put to the test. All these troops, however, the panzermen, anti-aircraft gunners, Fallschirmjäger and infantrymen, were not supermen. Most campaign histories of Normandy have gone out of their way to stress the Germans' expertise and how, man for man, they were superior to their Allied opponents in experience, equipment, doctrine, and resolute loyalty to their Führer. Nothing could be further from the truth. Their average age was much higher than that of their opponents. They had moved away from the war-winning formulae of their earlier doctrine, Many were inexperienced or medically downgraded after service in Russia. A strikingly high proportion had been previously wounded in action. All were ill-equipped and unfit. Some were not even German. And few had conducted much meaningful military training in 1944 in favour of strengthening their defences. As General Blumentritt observed of the divisions garrisoning the coastal areas, they possessed only two organic infantry regiments, weak artillery, and very limited mobility. Most of the officers and men had been wounded and were of limited medical status. They were not so much chosen men as broken men. While infantry formations were entirely reliant on horses or bicycles for mobility, even the much-vaunted panzer units had a great disparity of truck and tank types that militated against their effectiveness instead of adding to their performance. In 1946, Blumentritt concluded that most of the SS and Army panzer outfits which fought in Normandy had been employed both in the East and in the West. They had been reorganized several times and were not the divisions of 1939-40. All German units soon shrunk with combat casualties, which were not replaced. Blumentritt noted of tank formations, "The East swallowed those newly manufactured panzers. Hence, there were some panzer divisions without panzers, and others with 30, 50, or 60 panzers. 80 serviceable panzers were regarded as good." Just as the Allies exaggerated their achievements after the war, so the Germans tended to overstate their losses, attempting to demonstrate their ability to soldier on in extreme adversity. Blumentritt's observations of the panzer divisions may not be strictly accurate, but the gist of his comments was certainly true. The German war machine was nothing like as dangerous as supposed by the Allies in 1944. Yet, during and after the Normandy campaign, Hitler's armies gained almost superhuman status. Today they continue to enjoy a surprisingly undiminished reputation. The June to August 1944 battles were shockingly violent and viciously fought, and from some of the more laudatory reports of German manoeuvres, the reader might be forgiven for thinking the Allies were the vanquished and the Wehrmacht and Waffen-SS the victors. So where does the idea of Nazi military superiority come from? The effect of terrain worked a good deal in the Germans' favour and against the Allies, particularly the narrow roads winding through old villages, bocage hedgerows and stone-built Norman farmhouses, some medieval in origin with fortress-like architecture designed to keep out English pirates. All were tailor-made for ambushing opponents with automatic weapons and panzerfausts, handheld anti-tank weapons, of which the Reich's forces had a preponderance. The very many forests, woods, and copses, all in full leaf, assisted the Germans in concealing much from Allied eyes. Hitler's armies also started with an awesome reputation, despite being outmatched by superior Allied staff work, logistics, firepower, and air supremacy. The stature of the Nazi war machine, forged in North Africa, Italy, and on the Eastern Front, was still feared in 1944, though demonstrably hollowed out. It also helped Berlin that the Western Allies, particularly the 21st Army Group, were also excessively cautious, which played to the German inclination, despite their convoluted command, of tactical speed of reaction. Finally, it also suited many Allied commanders after the war to talk up the prowess of their opponents, making the achievement of subduing them all the greater. The same had occurred in Italy, where Field Marshal Sir Harold Alexander observed of the Fallschirmjäger defending Monte Cassino, "The tenacity of these German paratroops is quite remarkable. I doubt if there are any other troops in the world who could have gone on fighting with the ferocity they have." It is also easy to forget that the German main effort was still on the Eastern Front. Normandy was a secondary show for the Third Reich, but not so the Western Allies. The statistics confirm this. On 1 June 1944, Rundstedt had 58 divisions in the West. Elsewhere, however, lurked 228 divisions, mostly facing the Red Army. In the midst of invasion fever, Rommel was making arrangements to leave his headquarters for Germany during the first week in June. He had some important business to attend to. First, a visit to his wife and son Manfred at their home in Herlingen, midway between Stuttgart and Munich, Frau Lucy Rommel's birthday was on 6th June. Then the Field Marshal intended to drive on to Berchtesgaden and insist that Hitler release more reserves to Army Group B. Rommel could have cited many reports highlighting the shortcomings within his command. A 7th Army briefing note of 13th May had revealed the shocking statistic that it fielded an average of 2 anti-tank weapons per mile of front, while the 15th Army possessed double that. Neither were remotely sufficient for modern war. Whatever the motive, Rommel's departure amounted to a major lapse of judgment at such a crucial time. His journey, a full day to Herlingen, a second day with his family, another day's motoring to Berchtesgaden, at least a day with Hitler, before the two-day return leg to France, via the road networks of the day, promised to take him away from his duties for a minimum of 6 days, and possibly longer. In retrospect, it seems strange that such an important commander should waste several valuable days in his car. But with flying out of the question, and the Allies attacking every train, what else could he do? The weather worsened as he left La Roche-Guyon at 0700 hours on Sunday, 4th June, 2 staff officers riding with him. The conditions reassured him somewhat, forgetting his own maxim that the enemy would attack in poor weather. Nevertheless, Rommel felt it a perfect time to attend to important matters before the skies cleared and an invasion might again threaten. With Daniel at the wheel, his horse sped down the gravel drive and took the road to Paris. The French capital also beckoned to General Edgar Feuchtinger of the 21st Panzer Division. With the inclement weather, he had decided to spend the night there, wooing his mistress. As the cathedral bell of Notre-Dame de Saint-Lô tolled midnight on 5th June, a band of headquarters officers, led by the 84th Corps Chief of Staff, Oberstleutnant Friedrich von Kregern, and Intelligence Chief Major Friedrich Hein, knocked and entered Erich Marx's room for a surprise celebration. They bore with them a cake and, on a silver tray, some excellent bottles of Chablis. Their austere commander preferred soldiers' rations and usually refused such luxuries, with the admonition, "I do not wish to see these again as long as our country is starving," but on this occasion relented, as Tuesday, 6th June 1944, was his 53rd birthday. Meanwhile, many of Marx's senior officers had already driven to Rennes for their war game, each ordered to bring 2 regimental commanders with them. Starting at 1000 hours sharp on 6th June, they would test the scenario of an Allied airborne assault on Normandy. 3. Heading over there. Prime Minister King arrived today in a banker's suit to shake hands with a few of the men. He tried very hard to be pleasant, but wound up instead being political. It is hard to imagine him leading anybody anywhere. Even more strange that anyone would want to follow. Brigadier Harry Foster, 7th Canadian Infantry Brigade, 18th May, 1944. Yanks were not the only North Americans crossing the Atlantic to war in 1939-40. In contrast to the USA's studied isolationism, the Dominion of Canada chose to declare war on Germany a week after Britain, in September 1939. As Canada's Prime Minister, Mackenzie King, boldly announced, "It is now left to the British peoples and those of British stock to save the world." Partly to silence the strident French-Canadian opposition to the war, King promised there would be no conscription for overseas service. However, his country's pre-war militia was tiny. Combined, the full-time army and reserves numbered fewer than 55,000, though in time this would grow 13-fold to 730,000. As soon as it was mobilized, the 1st Canadian Division was sent to England in December 1939 and based at Aldershot, the huge British garrison complex built in the Crimean and Boer Wars, with parade ground discipline to match, which became Little Canada. Most of the 330,000 Canuck, the affectionate term for Canadians adopted during 1914-18, troops, who at some stage deployed to Britain, would pass through the old military town. Meanwhile, spurred by a sense of adventure and the opportunity to travel, the sort of motivations which through history have appealed to young men and women, Canada's youth flooded into the ranks of the part-time militia, some 58,000 before the dawn of 1940. The government also introduced conscription for home service, without the obligation to serve overseas, and the army which fought in Europe would remain almost until the end a resolutely all-volunteer force. Just before D-Day, on 18th May 1944, the Canadian Premier inspected his troops in southern England, making a poor impression on the 7th Infantry Brigade's commander, Harry Foster, and his officers. However, Foster recorded, "After everybody left, I reprimanded two officers for giving him a horse laugh during his talk. He may not look or sound like much, but he is our Prime Minister, and I will not tolerate disrespect." The Royal Canadian Navy was born in the Second World War. From 6 ocean-going vessels and 3,500 men, it would expand to become the third largest navy in the world, with 115,000 men and women in uniform and 434 RCN warships. Vital in winning the Battle of the Atlantic, 1944 would see 121 vessels, over a quarter of its fleet, crewed by 6,676 personnel, supporting the invasion of Normandy. The Royal Canadian Air Force had become an independent force only in 1938, when it numbered 150 officers, fewer than 1,000 other ranks, and operated 31 obsolete aircraft. It was effectively an auxiliary arm for land and naval units. By the war's end, the RCAF had trained 260,000 personnel. Canuck volunteer pilots fought in the Battle of Britain and would supply 17 squadrons for the RAF's 2nd Tactical Air Force, 2nd TAF, in France. Meanwhile, their country supplied Britain, principally by sea, with much-needed food, while making ammunition, 14,000 aircraft, 3,500 tanks, and 800,000 military vehicles, using American mass production methods and tooling. New Brunswicker Raymond Hickey grew up in a religious family and, to no one's surprise, was ordained a Roman Catholic priest in 1933. In June 1940, he was asked to become chaplain of the North Shore Regiment. He agreed, though at 35 felt he was rather old for the post. He sailed with the battalion from Halifax to Liverpool in 1941 and trained with them in England for the next 3 years in readiness for Normandy. Hickey saw his job as keeping morale high and coached the regimental team to become baseball champions of the Canadian Forces in 1942. An astute observer of the war, he recorded the impression an air raid made on the Canadian arrivals to Britain. Night after night, just as darkness was falling, up would go the awful wail of the sirens. In all directions, people would run to cold cement air raid shelters. On would go the searchlights that swept the sky like giant northern lights. From a distance would come the unmistakable ow, wow, wow of German planes. With a deafening roar, our anti-aircraft guns would open up. You huddled as small as you could, covered your head, held your breath, and waited for bombs that came with a terrifying whistle and shook the earth with an awful blast and covered the place with death and destruction. Vancouver-born James Montgomery Doohan was one of those who volunteered for the Canadian militia early in 1940, aged 20. He was surprised that he had to supply his own black boots and dismayed to find First World War equipment in widespread use. Almost immediately, he found himself in a field battery of Canada's 2nd Infantry Division and volunteered for overseas service. Soon commissioned, he spent much of his first year training before his unit arrived in England with the 3rd Division. He spent 3 uneventful years based at Aldershot, progressing by 1944 to the role of gun position officer with the 13th Field Regiment, while their wheeled 25-pounders had been replaced with American-made 105mm guns on a Sherman tank chassis. For aerial defence, their armoured vehicle mounted a Browning machine gun in a circular structure on the right-hand side that resembled a church pulpit. So, for ease, Lieutenant Doohan and the rest of the Canadian gunners dubbed their M7 105mm howitzer motor carriages simply priests. Doohan's 3rd Canadian Division was experiencing a frustrating war, for their comrades of the 2nd Division had already fought at Dieppe in response to governmental pressure to see their men in action at the earliest opportunity. 2 Victoria Crosses were won by Canadians during their 19th August 1942 raid on the French port, Operation Jubilee. the only major land assault on occupied France prior to Normandy. However, it sustained huge casualties, and of the mostly Canadian 6,086 who landed, 3,367, 55%, were killed, wounded, or captured. 50 U.S. Rangers had also landed, three of whom were killed, including Louisiana native Lieutenant Edward Lustelot, the first American to be killed in ground combat by German forces. The Allies put a brave face on Dieppe. Louis Mountbatten's official line then and subsequently was that important lessons about amphibious operations and likely German reactions to them were learnt, and for every soldier who died at Dieppe, 10 were saved on D-Day. Institutions will always seek to put a positive gloss on a major tragedy, and to suggest that Dieppe was in any way successful as a vital stepping stone to Normandy is akin to alleging that the Titanic disaster was an important milestone in passenger ship design. Notwithstanding the bravery of those present, Mountbatten's observations were in self-justification of a bungled and deeply flawed plan mounted by his combined operations. Most of the lessons learned about attacking a strong defended port were self-evident. When Canada's other division based in England, the 1st accompanied by the 1st Armoured Brigade and later the 5th Armoured Division, set sail from England to fight in Sicily and Italy from July 1943, Douin and his mates must have felt the war was passing them by. They were unaware that their formation had already been selected for the assault wave in France, whenever that was to take place. Born to Jewish parents in Toronto, Barnett Barney Danson was acutely aware of the threat Hitler's Germany posed to democracy. It was after the 1938 Munich crisis that he decided to join his local militia unit, the Queen's Own Rifles of Canada, the nation's oldest regiment, but had to wait until his 18th birthday in February 1939 before he could be officially sworn in. Danson enjoyed the training and lectures every Monday and Wednesday, and weeks away at the military camp in Niagara. May 1939 saw him as part of the Guard of Honour to greet King George VI and Queen Elizabeth in Toronto. He remembered a mounted escort of the Royal Canadian Dragoons and the Governor General's Horse Guards had placed itself in front, backsides facing us. Loyally and obediently we presented arms, and the horses proceeded to respond rudely to the excitement of the moment. Mobilised in June 1940 with the 8th Brigade of the 3rd Division, Danson and the Queen's Own sailed overseas in July 1941, escorted by a horizon full of First World War American four-stacker destroyers. These were 50 ex-US Navy warships being transferred to Britain under Lend-Lease. With us were many American civilians bound for Northern Ireland to build air bases, and together we became players in truly the largest floating crap game ever assembled. Later on, the Canucks would depart for pre-invasion training in Scotland, before returning to Hampshire in September 1943. Canadian officers, censoring their troops' mail, noted how relations between British civilians and Canadian troops continue to be very cordial, with not one adverse comment from our men about the British seen. This was in contrast to the Canadians' view of GIs, who seemed to them to be brasher, rowdier, and wealthier, which inevitably drew the British and Canadian troops closer together. Stephen Dyson, a British Churchill tank crewman, recalled, "Other than isolated bits of friction caused by Canucks up to their eyeballs in booze, we generally got on very well with them, although their vernacular on some things had a different connotation to ours, which led to misunderstandings at times." Such cooperation would prove vital on the battlefield, where both armies in any case were completely interchangeable, wearing the same scratchy woolen battle dress and distinctive soup bowl Tommy helmets pioneered in the First World War, and operating with the same ranks, doctrine, equipment, weapons, artillery, calibers of ammunition, vehicles and staff systems. Indeed, at a glance, until an accent was heard or the distinctive Canada shoulder flash was seen, they appeared exactly the same. Until their arrival on Britain's shores, Americans only knew of their future wartime ally through the broadcasts of Ed Murrow, CBS's star reporter based in London from 1937. He had pioneered live broadcasting during Hitler's occupation of Austria in 1938 and electrified American radio audiences with his reports at the height of the Blitz in his program London After Dark. With nightly bombing raids, Morrow echoed the tension of the era, that Londoners might not necessarily see each other the next morning, with his enduring sign-off catchphrase, "Good night and good luck." From 2 January 1942, this general ignorance of Britain began to change with the signing of orders activating the U.S. 8th Air Force, overseen by the red-headed Major General Carl Spatz, then in his 50th year. A native of Boyertown, Pennsylvania, and formerly named Spatz, he had a paternal grandparent who still spoke German, which induced Mrs. Spatz to add another A in 1937 to make their surname look less Germanic and more Dutch, and made sure it was pronounced Spots. However, everyone knew him as Tui because of his similarity to another red-headed West Point cadet named Tui. Spots was already familiar with England, having been a military attaché posted to London in 1940. He had even been arrested, dressed in crumpled tweeds, having wandered into a restricted area whilst witnessing an aerial dogfight near Dover. Thereafter, he signed himself into British military establishments as Colonel Carl Spatz, German spy. Within days, the US Air Forces in the British Isles, USAFBI, had come into being, and staff officers began arriving in London and at RAF Bomber Command's headquarters at High Wycombe. Under Spatz, Brigadier General Ira C. Aker, another German-American of Alsatian ancestry, headed up 8th Bomber Command. At the same time, fighter, air support for reconnaissance, transport and tactical bombing, and service commands were established. Spatz himself arrived on 15th June, creating the 8th's headquarters at Bushey Park, west of London. Their work would soon trigger the flow of hundreds of thousands of US airmen and their aircraft into Britain to take the fight to the Third Reich. Spatz's personnel also received their copies of Instructions for American Servicemen. Don't be misled by the British tendency to be soft-spoken and polite. If they need to be, they can be plenty tough. 60,000 British civilians, men, women and children, have died under bombs, and yet the morale of the British is unbreakable and high. A nation doesn't come through that if it doesn't have plain, common guts. The British are tough, strong people and good allies. The British have theatres and movies, which they call cinemas, as we do. But the great place of recreation is the pub. You will be welcome in the British pubs as long as you remember one thing. The pub is the poor man's club, the neighbourhood or village gathering place, where the men have come to see their friends, not strangers. That summer, one of Spatz's men, Lieutenant Will Seaton Arnett, flew with his squadron of B-17 Flying Fortress bombers across the North Atlantic in a 7-day staged flight. They had rest stops in Maine, Labrador, Greenland, Reykjavik and Stornoway on the Isle of Lewis, before landing at Prestwick, about 30 miles southwest of Glasgow. Pretty much hugging the Arctic Circle, this was one of two routes taken by all larger American aircraft, the smaller ones being shipped across with other Air Force personnel. Arnett's initial impressions, however, were not rosy, as his first letter home from Scotland observed. "I thought I'd seen everything, but this place takes the cake. The people are so backward it is pitiful. This seems to have been a wealthy place at one time. The homes and buildings are just like the pictures. The streets are narrow and very crooked. Bicycles are the main means of transportation. There are very few cars, and traffic is left-handed. The buses are two-deckers and very old. Scotland is almost as far north as Greenland, so it is pretty cold. The people of Scotland are very friendly, but their language is unusually strange and hard to understand." In Norfolk, the accent was equally hard to comprehend, as Captain Philip Pendleton Ardery, with the 389th Sky Scorpions Bomb Group, based at RAF Hethel, Norwich, recalled, "All in all, I liked England. My first contact with a real Englishman was when this old man came riding along on his bicycle. He stopped and said, 'Hey, here, mate.' We could hardly understand him. He wanted to know if we'd like him to do our laundry. We were tickled to death to let him do it for just a few shillings." also flying the northern route in a twin-engined B-26 Marauder medium bomber, was Baltimore-born Staff Sergeant Clarence Elmer Cy Syford. He had enlisted in the Army Air Corps in 1940, aware the U.S. might be going to war, and wanted to be a part of it. Initially training as a spotter on anti-submarine planes, Syford transferred to the 555th Squadron of the 386th Medium Bomb Group. The group was nicknamed the Crusaders, and we were the Red Devil Squadron. We crossed the Atlantic in a brand new B-26 along the northern route via Greenland and Iceland to Scotland. I flew as mechanic and top turret gunner, whilst our group's entire ground crew crossed on Queen Elizabeth. When we heard of their sailing conditions, I'm sure we had the better deal, recalled Syford, who would fly 72 combat missions in B-26s. Lieutenant Russell Chandler, Jr., also flew across the Atlantic in his twin-engined C-47 Goonie Bird transport. Flying had been a childhood dream, and he had qualified as a pilot in 1943. The Brits called them Dakotas. I liked that better than the Skytrain designation we used. Chandler and his squadron followed the southern route from Miami to Puerto Rico, Trinidad, British Guiana, and on to Recife, Brazil. Then we took the long hop to Wide Awake Air Base on Ascension Island in the middle of the Atlantic, and on to Freetown, Sierra Leone. Next to Marrakesh, Morocco, before heading north to England, more than 12,000 miles and about 70 hours of flying time. On arrival, Chandler was assigned to the 44th Squadron, 316th Troop Carrier Group, 9th Air Force, flying out of RAF Cottesmore near Nottingham. Also taking his four-engined B-24 on the southern route was Missouri-born Lieutenant Kurt M. Vogel. He had married and started a law degree before Pearl Harbor intervened to disrupt his life plan. Vogel enlisted before the draft and qualified as a pilot in 1942, but remembered the deaths of two colleagues in training. On returning to their barracks room, all of the belongings of these two cadets were gone, and the beds were realigned so that it appeared that they had never been there. This same procedure was also followed while flying combat. Known as Old Man Vogel, he was 27, in January 1944, the pilot flew his heavy bomber from Florida, where we were handed an envelope just prior to takeoff marked Secret Orders, and we were not to open it until 1 hour into the flight to Waller Field, Trinidad. It told us we headed for 8th Air Force, England. It could have been China, Burma, Africa, or Italy. Since I announced this on the intercom, I do not know how the other 9 crew members reacted, but each of them knew the 8th Air Force was suffering very heavy losses in the air over Europe. From Trinidad, they flew to Natal, Brazil. Whilst there, they named their B-24 Rough Riders, after President Theodore Roosevelt's regiment. The name was arrived at after a lot of discussion by the crew. Some of them probably would have liked something more current, but I had emphatically stated no nude or semi-nude girls. Their next stop was Dakar, French West Africa, where they were guarded by Senegalese native troops carrying long bayoneted rifles, wearing red fez caps, blue pants and khaki shirts. Then it was on to Marrakesh, and finally Valley Air Base on Anglesey, North Wales. Soon they made their way to RAF Horsham St. Faith, near Norwich, home of the 458th Bomb Group. Some of their B-24 colleagues ran out of fuel over the Bay of Biscay and were obliged to land on the first flat field they found near Land's End. Immediately they were surrounded by curious farmers bearing pitchforks and asking questions. This terrified the crew, who, unable to identify the broad Cornish accent, assumed they had landed in German-occupied France and drew their 45-inch Colt pistols to defend themselves. Fortunately for all, the large stars on the wings and fuselage proclaimed them as allies, and they were soon ensconced in the local pub. Lieutenant Malcolm Brannan of the 82nd Airborne Division wrote home to his sister of Nottinghamshire, "The country here is very much like USA, especially New England. Green lawns and lots of trees and pretty brick houses. There are loads of stores, called shops, I think, of all kinds and types, but we can't buy anything because all is rationed. Food is scarce, and so is beer and liquor, sweets and smokes. I see more buses, double-deckers and singles, trolleys, than I ever saw in the USA. There are very few taxis and very, very few private cars. The blackouts are real ones, not just practice, and have been going on for 5 years. According to the sheriff, that is, Nottingham, his way of getting round the censor, that is one reason that he hasn't caught Robin Hood. England's wartime travails were evidenced to newly arrived GIs by the British queue. But it irked their hosts that most Americans had no idea what a queue was or how to behave in one, although both sides soon found queuing was an ideal way to strike up a friendship, and, if necessary, sever it at the end. Americans, on the other hand, arrived with equally preconceived notions, courtesy of Hollywood, of the British as complete automatons to class and privilege, that they rarely thought for themselves, possessed no initiative, and would stop every 10 minutes for a tea break. The power of the old school tie in this great stronghold of democracy is a dangerous matter, thought Lieutenant Robert S. Raymond, an American volunteer in the RAF, like Leroy Gover, who would complete 30 missions with Bomber Command before switching to his own USAAF. He was convinced General Rommel would never have risen above the rank of NCO in the British Army. Both governments, therefore, put huge effort into improving relations between their respective armies and the civilian population. Two publications were astutely distributed to all secondary schools by the Ministry of Information. One was a 24-page paperback, written by BBC playwright Louis McNeice, Meet the US Army. The other, a specially commissioned edition of A Brief History of the United States, containing an introduction by John Wynant, US Ambassador. Winifred Pine was a Royal Navy Wren stationed at Kingswear near the Britannia Naval College, Dartmouth, then occupied by a U.S. naval unit. Our wrennery was on a hill overlooking the River Dart, and each morning we would wake up to the sound of Glenn Miller or the Andrews sisters coming through their loud hailer system, she recalled. They were always curious about us, as we were probably the first English women they had met. We found them to be courteous and well-mannered. I mainly remember the Americans for being extremely kind and generous to the children of Dartmouth, as they would often hire a hall in town to entertain them. The children would always leave with Hershey chocolate bars and other goodies. They also put on parties for us, and were horrified at the size of our rations. They, of course, had all of their rations brought over from the United States, and it was at their parties that I first encountered Spam and hot dogs. Hospitality invariably included dances in town and village halls. Near the ports, there was an endless stream of Welcome to Britain disembarkation dances. If run by the local community, these tended to be heavily stage-managed at first, where the invited females were assessed by the local vicar and his middle-class colleagues to ensure they were the right class of girl, ones who would not lead the GIs astray and were known not to sleep around. One 19-year-old remembered attending many camp dances, for which she was vetted by the Red Cross, and found them highly decorous and strictly chaperoned. At GI Army and air bases, such pettifogging restrictions lapsed, but US venues also witnessed lavish parties held for neighborhood youngsters, overflowing with candy and presents. For example, the 392nd Bomb Group at RAF Wendling in Norfolk hosted Christmas festivities for 160 orphans, refugees, and local schoolchildren. They were conveyed to the base in U.S. Army transport, shown the inside of a B-24, serenaded by the base orchestra, played movie cartoons of Popeye and Mickey Mouse, and served tea, cakes, and fruit jelly. Santa Claus then awarded each child a wrapped festive present and candy, bought with money donated by GIs. With full stomachs and full of Christmas spirit, the children were piled back into the trucks and taken home, remembered one of the organizers. Britons were quickly besotted with the idea of the USA and its inhabitants, but their only knowledge was furnished by Hollywood. A BBC poll of early 1942 observed that its respondents are simply without opinions of any kind or even prejudices about anything so remote as America. Such ignorance led the Times to report on 4th August 1942 that the new visitors were friendly and simple, rather than Hollywood stars or two-gun Texans with five-gallon hats. Their manners were good, though a little different from those in Britain. Americans were perhaps a little quicker on the uptake, but they made friends more easily. For Britons, this was their first sight of pinball machines, jukeboxes, both adjusted to operate with British coins, and jeeps, while most 1940s children were introduced to the dubious delights of peanut butter, candy, chewing gum, and Coca-Cola by these exotic visitors. "Got any gum, chum?" became a common street call to any American who must have wished the stuff had never been invented. To this, the invariable GI reply was, "Got any sisters, mister?" Sergeant Forrest Pogue recalled being engulfed by a mob of urchins, yelling the irksome phrase and being rescued by an old man who ordered them away, asked my pardon for the begging, and expressed shame because English children didn't used to be like that. Although he himself was ragged and poor, he had his pride for London and England. Pogue, later a distinguished official US historian of the war, remembered being accosted by a little lad near London's Tower Bridge. First he wanted candy, then, in order, gum, shoulder patches, and uniform buttons. He showed his knowledge of history by asking if I were a rebel or Yankee. Our conversation was brought to an abrupt halt when a girl of about 20 approached, bade him on his way, and asked for a cigarette for herself. She was not interested in history. 4. The Commandos. "We won't do much talking until we've done more fighting. After we've gone, we hope you'll be glad we came." Brigadier General Ira C. Acre, on taking command of the 8th Air Force in England, December 1942. For Americans serving far away from home, Christmas 1942 was a difficult time, and as many as possible were given leave. Posters around their camps suggested they spend the day with their civilian hosts. "Fill the chairs left empty by British fighting men. GIs, spend your Christmas at home with a British family." Those who took up invitations that first Yank Christmas were given special ration packs to share, containing rare or unknown commodities such as Spam, US spiced ham invented in 1937, fruit juice, evaporated milk, canned peaches, bacon, sugar, rice, and peas. Coffee, too, arrived with the visitors, and not just in tins of the usual beans, but in the form of freeze-dried granules from K-ration packs, the nation's first introduction to Nescafe instant coffee. Some more advice from the instructions for American servicemen. One thing to be careful about: if you are invited into a British home and the host exhorts you to "eat up, there's plenty on the table," go easy. It may be the family's rations for a whole week spread out to show their hospitality. The British know that gasoline and food represent the lives of merchant sailors, and when you burn gasoline needlessly, it will seem to them as if you are wasting the blood of those seamen. When you destroy or waste food, you have wasted the life of another sailor. GIs only realized how fortunate they were when faced with British home front rations of tea tablets with national dried milk, grated carrots to replace fruit in cakes, a grey, glutinous, fishy meat that might once have been a whale, powdered eggs which yielded a dull, yellow, rubbery-like apology for the real thing, meat containing cereal that I'd tasted like sawdust, and milk heavily diluted with water, as one disgusted GI noted. Staff Sergeant William B. Dowling was a crew chief with the 578th Bomb Squadron, based near Norwich, who remembered, "At the end of the war, I rode back to Massachusetts on a B-24. The first thing I did when I hit the ground was to give it a kiss. It was good to be back after 2 years away. The Red Cross greeted us with donuts and fresh cold milk. I'd forgotten it existed, because the only milk we saw in England was powdered, and I got so tired of it." Once word spread of the extra GI Christmas food on offer, so many invitations were extended to Americans that one base commander recorded receiving at least 50 invitations for every one available man. With the food, GIs introduced their own festive traditions, including Christmas crackers, while in return the Americans were offered advent calendars and candles. Despite the Nescafe, the instructions for American servicemen warned, "The British don't know how to make a good cup of coffee, but you don't know how to make a good cup of tea. It's an even swap." Another way into an English home was through getting their laundry done in exchange for rations. As Nottingham resident Harry Blankley recalled, "Those American boys were a godsend. With the shortages of food we had, Just imagine getting those chocolates and cigarettes. They brought their washing powder, soap, and clothes to be done, and came round later to pick it up. By the end of 1942, around 60,000 of Carl Spatz's USAAF personnel were building air bases in Britain, the majority situated within the old Saxon kingdom of East Anglia. Bulging out into the North Sea, with its flat, open fields, the region proved the perfect springboard for endless streams of heavy bombers to attack German-held Europe, and inevitably became the cannon's mouth for the US 8th Air Force. Within 2 years, with 71,000 GIs stationed in Suffolk, population 400,000, and another of East Anglia's five counties, one in six residents was American. When the Yanks occupied Wiltshire in May to June 1944, the ratio would be one in three. Bill Ong, an American arriving to build one of East Anglia's many airfields, was shocked at the sight of all the bomb damage and the whole atmosphere of dirt and dinginess around the docks. Maybe it was the wintry weather, the cold, grey days, no leaves on the trees, no sun. I wondered why the Germans wanted England at all. Yet Ong was left wondering whether Americans at home could have taken the punishment that the British had. Staff Sergeant Robert S. Arbib, Jr. of the 820th Engineer Aviation Battalion was also in the airfield building business. He observed that his unit had been trained to build temporary airstrips for fighter aircraft near the front line, not concrete air bases for heavy bombers in England. They were surprised to find that they had first to live under canvas before constructing their own wooden barracks. Arbib recalled, "My first taste of austerity travel on the railways of Britain came the day following our arrival in Scotland. The date was 18 August 1942, and the newspapers were full of the first American air raid on France. As the train pulled out of the station, the sky was growing dark. We could see nothing, not even a single light. This was our first experience with the blackout. We marvelled at its completeness. We slept on the floor. I was stiff and bruised when we arrived." The greatest concentration of GIs in the UK was initially within a 30-mile radius of Norwich, county town of Norfolk, where around 50,000 air and ground crew alone were stationed at 18 airfields. One of them was RAF Wendling, where Sergeant Bernard Sender worked as a turret mechanic on the B-24s of the 392nd Bomb Group. He remembered of his English home for 2 years. Wendling was just a stop in the middle of the Norwich to King's Lynn Road, 20 miles from either end. The airfield itself had been a quiet little farm. What we found when we got there was an undertaker, a church, a general store, and a pub. We lived in Quonset huts almost 2 miles away from the aircraft. Sometimes we walked, sometimes rode to work on bicycles. As winter drew near, the sun went down earlier. Let me tell you, it could be bitter cold at night over there, and we did all our work outside. You couldn't put spotlights up either, because we never knew when Jerry was coming around. In total, of the more than 140 UK airfields constructed or improved by the USAAF, Air Transport Command operated 7, while over 385,000 personnel of the 8th and 9th Air Forces occupied the others, mostly in eastern England. They would fly 350,000 sorties from these bases during their 1,000 days of being stationed in Britain. Each base tended to house a bomb or fighter group of 3 squadrons, initially amounting to 36 aircraft, plus a few spare. These establishments were huge, with up to 3,000 flying and ground personnel, ranging from cooks, bakers, welders and drivers, to medics, mechanics, armourers, ordnance and instrument repair technicians, plus aircrew, working on an average airbase of 500 acres. They exaggerated the impact of Americans by swamping nearby towns. Besides them, the personnel roster of the 493rd Bombardment Group, stationed at RAF Debich in Suffolk, included Bobby the headquarters cat, Boop, a ring-tailed monkey, and Dick, Esther and Nick, all dogs and mascots of the 860th, 861st and 863rd Bomb Squadron. The US 12th and 15th Air Forces also stationed units in the UK, but in 1943 moved their operations to the North African and Mediterranean theatres. The airmen were followed from 1942 by over 10,000 men of the US Navy's construction battalions, USNCBs, known as Seabees after their initials, who erected coastal bases throughout South Wales and all along Britain's south coast. Later they would prepare and man the invasion's floating harbours. US sailors manning warships also trickled into the UK, and by 1944 they would number 122,000, serving in a wide variety of shore bases, naval aircraft, landing craft and warships. The US Coast Guard too made an important contribution, crewing troop ships, 12 LSTs and 24 LCIs, as well as a flotilla of 60 small wooden cutters, which would cruise off all five invasion beaches as search and rescue craft, and were known as the Matchbox Fleet. The attack transports, USS Samuel Chase and Joseph T. Dickman, and the Utah headquarters ship, USS Bayfield, would be amongst the many Coast Guard manned vessels off Normandy on D-Day. The new year of 1943 brought hundreds of thousands more Yanks, mostly ground forces. 40 of the 89 US divisions deployed in combat passed through Britain, 4 in 1942, 9 in 1943, and the remaining 27 in 1944. Including Air Force and service troops, principally the Quartermaster's Corps of Supply Personnel, by May 1945, this had totaled 2,914,843 American servicemen and women arriving in the UK by sea, plus over 100,000 more by air. They appeared with their jitterbug dances and the unmissable tones of Glenn Miller's trombone. Volunteering for Air Force duty whilst at the height of his fame in America and Britain, Miller himself was credited with raising 49 U.S. Army bands and toured the USA with his own for a year before arriving in England with his musicians. Although for most, Glenn Miller was wartime Britain, he only started entertaining with his 62-strong troop, including support staff, on 14th July 1944, but reached audiences in the millions. Whilst transatlantic musical influences were slowly infiltrating the UK, notably jazz and blues, the regular dances held at American bases spread the popularity of swing, boogie-woogie and bebop, genres generally disdained by the BBC, thus giving them a popular edge. Many GIs could play an instrument, and units quickly formed bands, playing the latest jives from the US, which speedily bridged the military-civilian divide in England. The 508th Parachute Infantry, billeted in Nottingham, for example, boasted a 12-piece dance band which played all over town. Others formed vocal groups, which sang at concerts, but also in local churches. One facet of American life that surprised many Brits was the high proportion of church-going GIs. Bill Coughlin, a young evacuee living in Camborne in Cornwall, recalled, "I had the opportunity to hear all the black choirs from their segregated units. The Cornishmen sang in a stately, serious, hymn-like way, but in complete contrast, the black Americans had all the rhythms of Scott Joplin, George Gershwin, and the Jazz Age. The movements of their bodies in time with their voices turned the Methodist chapels where they performed from sedate places of non-conformity into palaces of swing." Cornwall being a musical place, the black GIs were not only praised for their performances, but were offered the food special to Cornwall. "We noticed their good manners, and I know now that the surprise on their faces confirmed that they did not expect white people to treat them as equals and brothers." British civilian women, on the whole, welcomed Americans, especially if they traded on access to Glenn Miller's orchestra, and benefited from their largesse, soon learning that with the candy and Coca-Cola came cigarettes and nylon stockings. Nylons, introduced by DuPont in 1939, were a welcome replacement for silk stockings, then unobtainable since Britain's imports of silk were diverted entirely into making parachutes. Metal zip fasteners for clothing and Ray-Ban aviator sunglasses, sold to the American public since 1937, arrived at the same time. Uniformed British females were not immune from Yankee charms either, as a US Army doctor noted from his jeep. "We passed some ATS, Auxiliary Territorial Service, Britain's uniformed women's army, girls, and they whistled and yelled at us, just as much as the males had flirted with passing girls back in the States." Wren Margaret Seeley, based at the stone frigate of HMS Squid, was often on the receiving end of friendly whistles and cheers as truckloads of GIs passed her bicycle. They threw us Mars bars and chocolate. It was a question of maintaining your dignity and pedalling on, or dismounting and grovelling about to pick up the candy, which, of course, we did because we were on rations. Mavis Boswell was a Wren stationed in Cornwall, who observed that because of the blackout, most servicemen carried small flashlights. Soldiers often kept a torch in their hip pockets, and I remember when dancing ballroom style with a nice officer, getting quite embarrassed, not realizing it was a torch in his pocket. This gave rise to our joke of the moment. A Wren asked a GI, "Do you mind taking that torch out of your pocket?" He replied, "Lady, that ain't no torch." Being buttoned up before, we shrieked with laughter at such humour, and became suddenly very liberated. I had never before encountered a condom, but at my first Christmas party in uniform, my fellow Wrens inflated them and let them fly around the room. I thought they were strange-looking balloons until it was explained to me that they were Frenchies. An American officer noted of a Home Guard dance. Some of the land army girls were in their uniform pants. The soldiers said all it took to get the pants down was one strong yank. Another claimed, the women's land army motto was back to the land, which became backs on the land when we arrived. Later on, when troops were sealed into their D-Day camps in May 1944, remembered Hampshire resident Brian Selman, Southampton Common was a huge transit camp packed with American soldiers. Their military police patrolled the perimeter with guns. The surrounding barbed wire was hung with no fraternization notices. Yet, through a hole in the wire, I saw numbers of young ladies entering and leaving with impunity. British men were unimpressed and saw their overseas visitors, invariably met in their leisure time at dances and in pubs, when brash and boisterous, if not drunk, as competition. However, one British soldier, when questioned, was forced to admit that in 1939 in France, British soldiers had pressed their advantage when they found they were paid more than the French. The instructions for American servicemen warned, British money is in pounds, shillings and pence. They won't be pleased to hear you call it funny money. They sweat hard to get it, and won't think any better of you for throwing money around. The British Tommy is apt to be specially touchy about the difference between his wages and yours. The English language didn't spread across the oceans and over the mountains and jungles and swamps of the world because these people were panty waists. You won't be able to tell the British much about taking it. They are not particularly interested in taking it any more. They are far more interested in getting together in solid friendship with us so that we can all start dishing it out to Hitler. Most resented by British males was the average American's huge spending power. True, the money was injected into the UK economy and brought some relief from the misery of the time. What else could they do with their earnings? GIs had no families of their own to go home to. Most had never left their own town or state, never mind their home country before. Clad in smart walking-out uniforms with shirts, ties and shoes, their counterparts had no off-duty attire, just battle-dress suits, collarless shirts and boots, as collars and ties were reserved for British officers. GIs were accused by their jealous rivals of being oversexed, overpaid and overhere. The standard American riposte was that the British were underpaid, undersexed and under Eisenhower. While an office worker recalled that every time "there'll always be an England" came over the wireless, the instant GI retort was, "as long as we're here to defend you." Many young boys learned to smoke at this time due to the generosity of GIs. But there was usually an ulterior motive. In exchange for a carton of Camels, Cuban cigars or large bars of unsweetened chocolate, a photograph of a sister or aunt was expected, with the promise to arrange a date. The instructions for American servicemen explained that you will naturally be interested in getting to know your opposite number, the British soldier, the Tommy you have heard and read about. You can understand that two actions on your part will slow up the friendship, swiping his girl and not appreciating what his army has been up against. Yes, and rubbing it in that you are better paid than he is. Frequently encountered were GI privates, young and very well paid, earning five times a British soldier's wage. US privates started on $50 a month, with a sergeant earning $85, a second lieutenant pulling in $150, and a captain $200, all tax-free. By comparison, British privates started on less than £3 per month, and sergeants at under £9, second lieutenants £15, and captains £25. The average British civilian earned up to £25 a month, all taxed at 50%. For both nations, these rates increased with overseas service, a standard 20% for the Yanks, specialist qualifications, time spent in the forces, and proficiency pay. For example, US and RAF airmen received far more, and US paratroopers an extra $50 per month. However, with an exchange rate of $4 to a British pound, a Tommy private was earning the equivalent of just $12 a month, less stoppages for clothing, food, and sometimes accommodation, compared to a GI's $50. Isaac A. Coleman, a black master sergeant stationed in England with the 377th Engineer General Service Regiment, recalled, "I got about $140 per month. You could send home part of your salary. I sent the maximum, $17, and the government sent $16. So $33 actually went home. It was a volunteer thing. The folks at home needed it as my father farmed." In an acknowledgement that British troops were underpaid, in August 1942 they received a 20% pay rise. Whereas the British serviceman still attended a tedious weekly pay parade at which he received his wage in cash, Americans were paid monthly, so received a much larger sum of disposable income to spend, often blown in the course of a few days. It was a truism that even the lowliest GI private, on the equivalent of a British captain's net pay, could dine out in the best London establishments, unlike his British counterpart, but only if he could negotiate his way past the imperious doorman. However, with his cap, smart uniform, and tie, the American often looked the part. All of this has to be seen in the context of the GI generation who grew up in the Great Depression. In little more than a decade, they had gone from chronic unemployment and near starvation to being able to outspend the old money of old England in the finest of hotels, rubbing shoulders with the likes of Glenn Miller, and doing so as servants of Uncle Sam. Wonders, indeed. Far from being resentful at being drafted, for many GIs, military service gave them not just a full wallet, but decent clothing and the best food they'd ever eaten. The consequent status of all Americans as big spenders, in their own eyes and those of the average Briton, has lasted ever since. Tommies were advised, through pamphlets issued by the Army Bureau of Current Affairs, "Americans are not Englishmen who are different, but foreigners who are rather like us." Dunkirk and Sicily veteran Bill Cheel, 6th Green Howards of 69th Brigade, remembered meeting his first GIs in April 1944. They appeared to be from a different planet. The smell from their kitchens was fantastic. They even had doughnuts for afters. We had rice pudding most times. They were well equipped, and I was sure they would give a good account of themselves when the time for action came. They were our allies, and it was hoped we would learn from one another. They were very good-natured and treated us like friends. On the other hand, two soldiers in the 50th Northumbrian Division, Corporal George Richardson and Sergeant George Self, remembered that troops from their brigade of ex-miners from the grim landscape of northeast England gained a fierce reputation for picking fights with the GIs. On returning home from the Mediterranean, British women wouldn't look at us. Nobody wanted to know. The Americans were going around with lots of money and half a dozen medals and had never seen action. This went on for weeks, until Eisenhower himself paid them a visit. "No way can you cooperate with the US Army if you're fighting with them in the streets of England. I want you to be friends and find out you can be friends," the Supreme Commander reasoned with them. British girls, like the rest of the population, obtained their view of America from the cinema, which suggested that the USA was entirely Chicago with its gangsters, the Wild West and cowboys, or California and Manhattan. Immaculate clothes, penthouses with cocktails, martinis at six. There was no concept of Minnesota and Montana in between. A UK Home Office survey in 1945 reported that British girls saw the USA as a magic country and American proneness to spoil a girl made them attractive to suitors. One 19-year-old Nottingham girl with stars in her eyes remembered the 82nd Airborne Division invading her city. I mean, just take the uniform the American paratroopers wore. It was fantastic, and we were attracted to them straight away. You must imagine what it was like back then. Before the war, all we could do for entertainment was to go to the pictures, and most of the films we saw were made in Hollywood. So for us to actually meet and hear these young men talk like our screen idols was, to us, like something out of this world, she recalled. We had been at war for nearly 5 years, suffering daily hardships through rationing. So the arrival of the Americans to our city brought a welcome change and offered a ray of light to our otherwise drab and boring lives. Airmen of any nationality with wings were much sought after by young women, and not just because of their pay and uniforms. There was a genuine romance attached to the concept of flight, which has still not eroded with time. Not only that, but in 1943-4, Hollywood came to England in the form of several glamorous figures associated with the U.S. Army Air Force. Not least among them, as we have seen, was Major Glenn Miller with his Air Force band, but also Major James Stewart, who had already wooed cinema-goers in 1939 and 1940 with Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, Destry Rides Again, and The Philadelphia Story. He was now commander of the 703rd Bombardment Squadron, flying B-24 Liberators out of RAF Tibbenham in Norfolk. Then there was Captain Clark Gable, reputed to have exchanged the second highest salary in Hollywood for a lowly USAAF captain's pay, who, throughout 1943, flew B-17 combat missions with the 351st Bomb Group based at RAF Polbrook, whilst making a film about air gunners. His air war documentary was released in 1945 as Combat America, which Gable, by then a major, also narrated. When he left the military, his release papers were signed by another Hollywood actor-turned-soldier and future president, Captain Ronald Reagan. Technically, they were part of the USAAF's motion picture unit, whose ranks were exclusively film industry professionals who had donned uniform. Their best-known contribution to America's war effort was the 1944 movie Memphis Belle, a story of a flying fortress. The documentary was the story of one of the first B-17s and her crew to complete 25 combat missions, flying out of RAF Bissingbourne between November 1942 and May 1943. Leave passes to the big English towns were popular, but underlined differences between us, the American invaders, and them, the occupied Britons. Every major town had a range of servicemen's clubs where enlisted ranks, both GIs and their foreign counterparts, could relax, of which the American Red Cross-run Rainbow Corner at the junction of Piccadilly Circus and Shaftesbury Avenue in London was the best known. As dance band leader Corporal Jim McDowell of the 44th Bomb Group, based at RAF Shipdham, Norfolk, recalled, "The Rainbow was a magnet for off-duty GIs. In the heart of London, it was where the homesick servicemen would go. You could shoot pool, play jukeboxes, and have your hair cut in a hometown barbershop. There were donuts served by great gals. You could drink, sleep, shower, anything you needed. It was a lifesaver for the guys." Generally, London was an extraordinarily cosmopolitan experience for most Americans brought up outside of New York City. McDowell remembered, "At times it was so foggy in London that you literally could not see your hand in front of your face. Then we had the blackout. You had blankets over each door that you went through and all windows. No light was allowed, period. Nothing that could be seen from the sky." GIs also discovered that wartime London had lost its colour. The beefeaters were gorgeous no longer, as they shed their medieval costumes for modern battle dress, and strict blackout regulations stymied much late-night activity, for plays and movies opened in late afternoon, so that the streets might be well emptied by the time darkness fell. The cosmopolitan nature of the representatives of empire, troops of government in exile, different accents of British soldiers, and shoulder patches of foreign forces, most of whom wore British battle dress, in London streets, brought home to GIs the full extent of the Allied alliance of which they were now a part. When speaking of the Anglo-American coalition that invaded the continent, we must not overlook the 35,000 free French, 25,000 Poles, 3,200 Czechs, 2,000 Belgians, a similar number of Dutch, and 1,750 Norwegian service personnel, as well as 170,000 Canadians who roamed England by the end of 1943 and likewise were preparing to cross the Channel. All were prey for the Piccadilly Commandos. The contemporary novelist Anthony Powell, in his 12-volume epic, A Dance to the Music of Time, refers to London's painted ladies plying their trade in the blackout by flickering small electric torches on their legs. There were, as Powell's anti-hero, Lieutenant Colonel Kenneth Widmerpool, observed, plenty of pretty little bits in the blackout. The observant U.S. Army historian Forrest Pogue explained, Piccadilly, I take it, has always had its quota of streetwalkers, but the prices offered, from £5 to £25 or $20 to $100, the latter for an evening of excess, steak dinner and bed included, as the troops came up to London for that last furlough before they shoved off for the continent, brought girls from all over the United Kingdom, looking all the more glamorous with a fur coat bought from the proceeds of 1 month's activities. The former four-shilling girls of the London slums suddenly found themselves squired by sergeants and colonels. Such prices were astronomical by the standards of the day, even to Americans. Honey, I want to rent it, not buy it, became the GI response to some of the extortionate sums demanded. These Piccadilly Commandos and the Hyde Park Rangers were eulogized by U.S. airmen in the nose art on their aircraft. One B-17 was christened Piccadilly Commando. She was shot down over Guernsey on New Year's Eve, 1943. Paul Wagner, a B-17 pilot with 600 Squadron, based in Hertfordshire, remembered being curious to see what the action was at Piccadilly Circus. Sure enough, right across from the sandbagged statue of Eros at the centre of the circus were the famous Piccadilly Commandos, who strolled openly along the street. They brazenly offered good times to servicemen wearing the uniforms of a dozen countries. To Wagner, an American raised in the puritanical culture of the Great Depression, this open discussion of sex for sale, carried out in broad daylight by girls who looked exactly like their wholesome American counterparts, was most astounding. He recalled that the price for an evening's entertainment ran about $16. Many of the girls were young. 18 was not an unusual age, and were often quite pretty. They also included the likes of Marthe Watts, a somewhat older but enterprising French prostitute who had arrived in London before the war and was a prolific offender with over 400 court appearances for soliciting. She had earned her living on her back in Spain, Italy, France, and North Africa, but not until she came to Mayfair's Stafford Street did she have to cater for clients who wanted to be tied up and beaten. Her wartime record was apparently 49 clients on VE Day. Wallace Patterson of the 448th Bomb Group, which flew B-24 Liberators from RAF Seething, an airbase near Norwich, remembered a weekend pass spent in London. After a wild cab ride from Liverpool Street Station, we put up at the Red Crown in Clifford Street. Immediately we washed, had supper, and went to the Regent Palace for a drink and to watch the Piccadilly Commandos at work. There were more of them inside the hotel and on the streets. They'll back the boys up in an alley for $8, take them home for from $12 to $80. They're a pretty sorry lot, most of them, but a few people said some of them had to do what they do or starve, while others are financing future businesses. Stephen Dyson, a British tank crewman with the 107th Regiment Royal Armoured Corps, recalled thinking the invasion of France would be a devastating blow for the prostitutes, who now had to vie with one another amid intense competition to attract customers. After being accosted several times as we walked from Piccadilly Circus to Soho, I commented, I wouldn't be surprised if they put up sale notices and paraded with sandwich boards advertising their prices. An 8th Air Force GI remembered, one gal had a fur coat on, and underneath that she didn't have any clothes on. True story. Well, the guys got in line to hug her. Far more upmarket were the haunts of British officers who introduced their comrades-in-arms to the likes of Mrs. Fanshawe's high-class private hotel in Knightsbridge, or Rosa Lewis, proprietor of the Cavendish Hotel in St. James, who was well known for finding suitable companions for the well-bred in need of such entertainment. In the former, a guards officer was rumoured to have been shown a room, only to encounter his own sister. Senior American staff based in the UK eventually complained about the more overt forms of prostitution, with the resultant venereal disease infection rates. Brigadier General Paul Hawley, senior US surgeon in Britain, concluded that 30% of all VD cases among GIs were contracted in London, whilst Liverpool, Bristol and Bedford, the latter a hub of several 8th Air Force bases, accounted for a further 27%. The Home Office was obliged to pursue the matter when a Foreign Office minister, Richard Law, suggested that if American soldiers contract VD in this country, they and their relatives in the United States will not think kindly of us after the war. As a result, London's police force investigated. Recently declassified is the August 1942 report by Superintendent E. Cole of the West End Central Division of the Metropolitan Police. In it, he noted that alongside the regulars of the oldest profession, many quite young female munitions workers were drawn to the West End by the promise of easy money from the new visitors. He surveyed the range of ladies on offer. Those in Burlington Gardens were rather expensive. Maddox Streets were overwhelmingly French, a colony amongst themselves, clean and businesslike, who rarely cause any trouble. The Piccadilly Commandos were of the lower type, quite indiscriminate in their choice of client and persistent thieves. Glasshouse Street was similar to Piccadilly, perhaps a slightly better class, whilst Old Compton Street in Soho supplied the lowest type of all drabs. Cole also surveyed various venues, noting the Woolly Lamb, Chappies and Eves were notorious for their resident ladies, but GIs visiting the aforementioned Rainbow Corner or staying at the Washington Club and 100 Piccadilly, all US establishments, were also at risk on account of the modern version of the camp follower, the good time girl, some in their early teens, who swarm and pester American soldiers, clinging to their arms, refusing to be shaken off, telling stories of poverty. Another report from September 1943 claimed that Leicester Square at night is the resort of the worst type of women and girls consorting with men of the British and American forces. Of course, the American soldiers are encouraged by these young sluts, many of whom should be serving in the forces. At night, the square is apparently given over to vicious debauchery. Understandably, US servicemen were reticent in memoirs and letters about their physical encounters with the opposite sex, but the ex-Eagle pilot, Leroy Gover, in the USAAF from late 1942, reminisced in the 1980s about his encounters with Rose, married to a British Army officer stationed in the Middle East. "I met her one night when I was at a pub having beer. She got up, came over, and opened my greatcoat to see if I had wings. When she saw them, she dumped the guy she was with. The first night we went to her apartment, and wow, did I learn some things. Anyway, the last train left the station near her apartment at 2200 hours, so I often missed it. It was fine to stay with her all night, but I always had to sneak out in the morning, because she didn't want her neighbours to know she was entertaining a male friend." On the other hand, WAF servicewoman Joan Wyndham recalled, "We only went out with our own kind. The pilots were heroes. If we could, we'd only go out with an RAF boy who'd got his wings. The others we called wingless wonders." The Piccadilly Commandos and other enthusiastic amateurs also invaded that ultimate male preserve, the English public house. These were considered generally a men-only and often working-class environment before the war. Newspapers still referred to pubs in inverted commas, as if accepting the abbreviation somehow lowered journalism in the eyes of their middle-class readership. In wartime, these drinking venues became classless as everyone sought refreshment, and young women started appearing in them, invariably on the arm of a GI. Civilian Dougie Alford recalled of his local tavern near St. Just, Cornwall. Every night a truckload of 15 or 20 Yanks would arrive at the Queen's Arms. Ladies didn't go to pubs in those days, but when the GIs arrived, some of the older girls started. That was the beginning of women going to the pub in our village. One American visitor commented that the pub was so much a part of the Yank in England that it would have to be remembered by the scriptwriter who does the European War movie. Troops were amused when pub landlords, at the end of licensing hours, another novelty for Americans, would call out, "Time, gentlemen, please, and you bloody Yanks too," which they took in the spirit with which it was given. In cities, pubs tended to be always crowded, the air foul, with barmaids who looked as if they were hired more for their ability as bouncers than dispensers of brew. However, the same serviceman observed that in the quieter country pubs, GIs learned not only the game of darts, the rules of shove halfpenny, but also words of a dozen naughty songs. An airman with the 493rd Bomb Group, stationed at Debbidge in Suffolk, pronounced D-bark by the Americans, but not by the locals, who insisted on Debbidge, reflected, "Odd, these British pubs. The Yanks seem to think that a pub wasn't worth walking into unless it was least a century old, and nearly every Britisher would boast that his father, grandfather, or great-grandfather had drunk ale in the same chair. All the British smoke, from little brother and sister to grandpa and grandma, so that after an hour, many of the fellows claimed they needed a radar set to find their way through the fog to the bar." Yet this was a very different culture to the saloons in the United States, and the novelty of loafing around a piano singing old-time music hall greats whilst quaffing the warm ale quickly waned. GIs missed their music and the baseball league results from back home. If British music was different and behind the times, then their sport was a complete mystery. Cricket, football, and rugby left all GIs nonplussed. To them, also, the BBC's radio offerings were stale. America had already, before the war, spawned a massive network of commercial radio stations, which offered a wide selection of music, drama, and comedy. On the outbreak of war, Auntie, as the BBC was affectionately known, replaced all its regional programmes with the single home service. From it grew comedy and popular music programmes, including Vera Lynn's Sincerely Yours, and it was forced to adopt a more informal style, including a forces programme and a European service, broadcasting news in French, German, and Italian. Little of this appealed to the visiting Yanks, hence Eisenhower's personal initiative, which resulted in the launch, on Independence Day 1943, of the American Forces Network, AFN, still in business today. The first day's wireless programming included 5 hours of Bing Crosby, Dinah Shore, and Charlie McCarthy, pre-recorded in the USA. By June 1944, its popularity had resulted in the 5 hours stretching to 19. On D-Day, the top 10 US radio requests included 4 by Bing Crosby and others by Dinah Shore, Jimmy Dorsey, and Judy Garland. Officers and enlisted men tended to drink separately, an 82nd Airborne GI remembering, "There was an unwritten agreement that we didn't frequent their pubs and they didn't ours. We also learned that darts was an Englishman's game and that the Americans' function was to lose and buy the drinks." However, Lieutenant Jack Bryant of the B-24 Liberator-equipped 486th Bomb Group, stationed at Sudbury, recollected, "After partaking of various beverages over the course of the evening, it was necessary to make use of a facility called a water closet. It was close to pitch black. I waited my turn. Then one of the Englishmen spoke to another beside him, and, showing forbearance impossible for an American, said, 'Pardon me, old chap, but you're urinating on my leg.'" This fervent wartime drinking culture and potential American gift to the British birthrate was not necessarily due to glamour, money, or loose morals, but, in the case of airmen, a reflection of the fact that each beer or fumbling kiss in the blackout might be their last. Red Kamarek, of the 93rd Bomb Group, was a tail gunner on a B-24 Liberator named Yardbird. As one of the earliest arrivals in England, flying out of RAF Alconbury in Cambridgeshire, he recalled that near his base was a billet for 23 bonny Land Army girls, all of whom were spoken for. "We met them the second night at the Nissen hut next to the road. I began a romantic interlude with Jeannie with the light blonde hair. The girls worked in the surrounding fields and used to wave as we taxied out to the runways. They confided that they knew when we were going on a mission by either the early takeoff or the length of runway it took to get off the ground. What a war. Mission in the morning, dating in the evening. Bed and blankets at night, that was our theme song. Major Harry H. Crosby, lead navigator with the 100th Bomb Group, flying B-17s out of RAF Thorpe Abbotts in Norfolk, completed his full tour of 25 missions, and, when the odds were against even surviving a tour, signed on for several more. A gentle soul, he once, when over the target, suddenly diverted his squadron from bombing Bonn on a recollection that Beethoven had been born and gone to school in that city. Crosby spoke for many in the 8th Air Force when he observed that at 9 o'clock in the morning we might be bombing Berlin and by midnight be at a fancy dance in London. Alternating between the two was disorientating to say the least, if not downright nerve-wracking. This was the purpose of Glenn Miller's concerts, the dances at airbases and leave passes to London, to unwind. As Forrest Pogue observed, and as generations of servicemen will attest, the taut nerves and inattention that accompany the stress of combat were best relieved by partying, alcohol or sex, or all three. 5. Warm Hearts. Here you are on this little island surrounded by northern mists. I cannot give you any guarantees on the weather, but can guarantee that you will be welcomed by warm hearts. Winston Churchill, welcoming US troops to Britain. Most of the great tidal wave of GIs who arrived in the United Kingdom in 1943-4 came by sea. American service personnel were generally assembled at Camp Kilmer, New Jersey, and taken to their ship waiting in New York Harbor. Herded like cattle, there was no other way. They struggled under the weight of 100-pound kit bags, webbing, packs with bedrolls, rifles, and steel helmets. Often a band played whilst they climbed the gangway onto, most usually, a converted peacetime passenger liner. Accommodation was spartan and the holds crowded with makeshift canvas and steel hammocks, built three high. Ventilation was poor. GIs were rarely told their destination before they set sail. The crossing was not without extreme risk. In February 1943, the 6,000-ton troop ship Dorchester was torpedoed off Newfoundland, with a loss of 672 out of 902 on board. Unless men found space in a lifeboat, their chances of survival in the unforgiving North Atlantic were zero. Nurse Mildred A. McGregor, aboard the 81,000-ton Cunard luxury liner, RMS Queen Mary, remembered their orders. There will be absolutely no smoking on deck at blackout. Positively no flashlights are to be used outside of enclosed areas. If anyone has a radio in his possession, it will be confiscated for the duration of this voyage. You should also be aware that Hitler has offered a $250,000 reward to any of his seagoing vessels for sinking Queen Mary. I remind you again that you must have your life preserver, your canteen full of water, and your survivor rations on you at all times. Should any of you fall overboard, this ship will not turn back for any reason. Her sister ship, RMS Queen Elizabeth, hosted fighter pilot Lieutenant Norman J. Budd, Fortier from New Hampshire, as he crossed the Atlantic. Built to accommodate 3,000 passengers in luxury, on this trip she carried two fighter groups and an entire infantry division, close to 16,000 men, but not in luxury. Three GIs took turns sleeping on the same bed, each for 8 hours over a 24-hour period. The feat was only replicated on the Queen Mary, known as the Grey Ghost, from the grey camouflage job both ships received. Virginian Sergeant Robert Bob Slaughter, with the 116th Infantry of 29th Division, was one of those who had watched the Statue of Liberty fade into the distance when aboard the Queen Mary in September 1942. The British food was, in a word, terrible. This was my introduction to wartime rations, and I never did get used to them. On his voyage, the liner collided with her escorting cruiser, HMS Curaçao, slicing her in two. In minutes, 332 British sailors died before our horrified eyes. The stern of the cruiser bumped the port side and quickly sank in Queen Mary's wake. The much larger bow, black smoke pouring from its funnel, stayed afloat for about 6 minutes before it, too, was swept into our wake. The broken Curaçao slowly raised its nose until almost vertical, then slid backward into a sea of bubbling foam. Fitted with 40mm anti-aircraft guns, the two Queen's greatest defense was speed. Sailing at 28 knots, too fast for German submarines or surface vessels, the pair traveled unaccompanied by escorting warships, their security increased by zigzagging at regular intervals. At such speeds, passage from New York to Greenock in Scotland took 5 days. As the 37 officers, including Bud Fortier and 252 enlisted men of the 354th Fighter Squadron, disembarked from the Queen Elizabeth, they were advised to wear their steel helmets. "Because of enemy activity?" Fortier asked. "No, sir," came the reply. "It's the seagulls." He recalled, "The steel helmets protected our heads, but most of us wore messy badges of passage on our uniforms when we reached the dock." The Queen Mary experienced more bad luck that December on another New York-Scotland run, when, laden with 950 crew and 10,389 GIs, including Nurse McGregor of the 3rd Auxiliary Surgical Group. Her unit comprised very valuable medical personnel, including 216 officer surgeons, anaesthetists, dentists, 227 enlisted men and 122 nurses from every state of the Union. This was the Queen Mary's first voyage since the Curaçao collision, which had kept her in dry dock for 2 months. On the third day out, she hit a squall, which developed into a storm on the fourth, and by the fifth day at sea, a full-blown hurricane. The waves grew more intense until one broke windows on the bridge 90 feet above the ocean, while others blew open portholes, flooded cabins, and took lifeboats and bolted down deck furniture as though they were made of paper. "The Queen battled the fierce storm for 3 days," McGregor wrote. "At times, the ship lifted so high on a wave that her huge propeller blades were exposed. Several British seamen manning the crow's nest high over the deck were swept away. At its peak on 11th December, the ship rolled to an astonishing 52 degrees, and the crew thought she was going to capsize. Maritime experts later concluded she was only 3 degrees from the roll becoming fatal, with catastrophic results for all on board. But, spaniel-like, the rugged ship brushed off the wave and continued her voyage. Many people fell. The ship's hospital began to fill with the injured as well as the seasick. Time dragged endlessly for those lying in their bunks, retching each time the ship hesitated on the crest of a 10-story wave, then plunged forward into the void. To top it off, Captain Ralph Coffey had to operate on a fellow traveller with acute appendicitis, McGregor recounted. Of their arrival, she observed, "We were 2 days off schedule, and the convoy that had been sent to escort the Queen into harbour had difficulty in locating us. They guided her through the submarine net into the estuary, where we were greeted by blasting horns and raised flags. The Queen raised her Union Jack as the guns roared. She had survived the worst storm of her career." By the war's end, Queen Mary would have carried 765,429, mostly US, military personnel, including the still unbroken record of 16,683 on a single vessel during a July 1943 transatlantic crossing. McGregor's horrific voyage later came to the attention of a writer named Paul Gallico, who collected accounts from several terrified GIs on board, and 25 years later used them to pen The Poseidon Adventure, about a huge luxury liner which rolled all the way. Lynchburg native Lieutenant Harry P. Carroll of the 356th Fighter Group was travelling with Bud Fortier in calmer seas on the Queen Elizabeth. "It was thrilling when we saw British Spitfires come off the coast of Ireland to greet us." New Yorker Hal Baumgarten was another GI from the 116th Infantry who, like Bob Slaughter, crossed in the luxury of 5 days, in his case aboard a requisitioned French liner, the 44,300-ton SS Île-de-France, the world's third-largest passenger vessel at that time. When he caught up with the rest of the 116th, known as the Stonewall Brigade, because of its southern composition and Civil War heritage, in Plymouth, they were warned, 2 out of 3 of you are not going to make it back, because you are going to be the spearhead for the Second Front. On the same ship as Baumgarten was the Irish-American Mike Joseph Daly, a private bound for the 18th Regiment of America's oldest division, the 1st, known affectionately as the Big Red One. On his last night in New York, Daly had enjoyed a live performance by Nat King Cole off-Broadway, but, unable to produce a leave pass when challenged by a roving MP, had been arrested. Consequently, he spent his transatlantic crossing cleaning pots and pans in the officers' mess galley. Once in England, he found himself in the Somerset coastal town of Minehead, preparing for D-Day. The 1st Infantry Division had already seen action in Tunisia and Sicily before returning to England in November 1943, and the greenhorn Daly, albeit the son of a professional soldier who had commanded doughboys, the affectionate term for 1917-18 American soldiers during the First World War, therefore had the hard task of integrating himself into a unit of already battle-hardened GIs. Also attached to the 1st Division was Chaplain John G. Burkhalter, a Southern Baptist minister and, before that, a professional boxer for 8 years. In 1942, he had heeded a call to preach the gospel in the U.S. Army and, after negotiating the Atlantic, joined the division training in Wales. He was soon well known, holding field services under the trees, heralded by jeep and trailer, which carried his portable organ, desk, typewriter, and songbooks. The U.S. Army newspaper, Stars and Stripes, described him as one who looks and lives like a combat chaplain. In appearance, Chaplain John G. Burkhalter is more than a match for the toughest combat soldier. He stands before his congregation in a faded fatigue uniform, feet braced, chest thrown out, jaw thrust forward. His strong-looking hands hold firmly to the hymn book. Clearly, the ex-boxer cut an impressive figure. He stands there, a powerful figure, his eyes meeting every man's glance like a boxer looking for an opening. When he talks, he speaks like a coach addressing a group of athletes in training. He doesn't harangue or plead or scold. His words carry his own conviction and confidence in what he is saying. At the other end of the scale to the two queens was the boat conveying a Wisconsin Signals sergeant, Don R. Marsh, a 10,000-ton Liberty ship named George Sharswood, which he soon nicknamed the Ship from Hell. Marsh recollected, "Its speed was a maximum 11 knots, if the screws of the single propeller remained in the water long enough, but they seldom did." He remembered her armament included a 4-inch cannon on the stern. This ancient piece still bore the brass plaque on its side that said it was on loan, reclaimed from a public park in the city of Philadelphia, and manufactured in 1903. The Navy sailors on board refused to test-fire it for fear it might burst the barrel. Marsh's fears rose further when he learned that on the bridge were 4 25-man lifeboats, 2 per side. The lifeboats were designated for the civilian crew only and off-limits to all soldiers. Marsh and his buddies were expected to use life rafts. A Signal Corps German-speaking linguist, Sergeant Carl Danneman of Houston, Texas, wrote home of the difference of British troopships over American. First, they used hammocks for sleeping, and second, Britain's wartime food shortages were evident. The average lunch consisted of 2 pieces of bread with 2 slices of bologna, Bologna sausage, coffee and 1 apple per person. On the other hand, the evening meal was quite adequate. Boiled beef or roast mutton, with potatoes, Brussels sprouts, tea and jello for dessert. Breakfast would be porridge. On Sunday, powdered eggs and a bit of bacon. He was unaware that in austerity Britain, this would be a feast. Michigan-born Donald R. Burgett of the 101st Airborne enjoyed an 11-day Atlantic crossing in September 1943 aboard HMS Empire Anvil, an American ship transferred to Britain under Lend-Lease that would later land troops on Omaha Beach. Landing at Belfast, Burgett recalled some of the troopers were throwing packs of cigarettes onto the dock, and the Irish labourers were scooping them up as fast as they hit. But we soon found out that everything was rationed here. Everything. Within days, Burgett and his colleagues had absconded from their base for a dance in the local village. Reflecting the general social confidence of the average American, he remembered the scene. There were civilians and GIs all drinking and having a ball. At the moment they were singing Roll Me Over in the Clover to the accompaniment of an old piano in the corner. We put our caps on, minded our manners, and soon each of us had a girl sitting on our laps. Others in the 101st were not so lucky. The 502nd Parachute Infantry had much earlier embarked on SS Strathnaver, which en route sprung a leak and was obliged to put into St. John's, Newfoundland, for lengthy repairs. Abandoning the Strathnaver, the paratroopers completed their voyage aboard a former Swedish liner, USS John Ericsson, but their transatlantic journey had taken 44 days. In the same convoy, and also aboard the John Ericsson, was Alabaman Lieutenant Belton Youngblood Cooper of the 3rd Armoured Division. With a total of 9 troopships carrying his entire division and men of the 101st Airborne, they joined 9 tankers loaded with fuel and supplies and were escorted by the battleship Nevada and 9 destroyers. Cooper shared a cabin with 5 other officers, but noted the enlisted men slept in the holds in bunks stacked 5 high. When not hot bunking, each soldier had to carry his duffel bag holding all his personal gear with him everywhere on board. Cooper witnessed one exasperated GI, on finding nowhere to rest with his burden, throw his bag overboard into the waves. On arrival, the 3rd Armoured was sent to Bruton in Somerset. Making the transatlantic hop on another of the 27 wartime passages made by the John Ericsson was Montanan Herbert Weinbrenner with the 358th Infantry of the 90th Division. His voyage was in April 1944, when the Atlantic threw him around. Of his own admission, I numbered among the sorriest of land lovers and suffered seasickness almost immediately. To this day, bad memories of pea soup and chocolate bars haunt me. When ordered to explain his absence from boat drill and other activities, he explained to his battalion CO, "Sir, in this state, I'm going down with the ship." He spent his voyage below decks, until gratefully setting foot on Liverpool's docks. The troops were immediately scattered around Birmingham and Warwickshire by train. Ultimately destined for Omaha Beach, New Yorker Chuck Hurlbut of the 299th Engineer Combat Battalion had left New York City in April 1944 aboard the 7,000-ton transport SS Exchequer. He particularly remembered the U-boat threat. About halfway over, we get a submarine alert. That's scary. You're out in the middle of the Atlantic. Everybody put on a life jacket. You all get up on deck and it's dark as hell. There was no moon that night. And you just wait because you don't know what the hell's happening. But we hear pretty soon that some of our destroyers found the sub. They depth bombed and they got it. That felt pretty good. Don Marsh, in his Ship from Hell, remembered of his slow, plodding voyage that some read their Bibles or said their rosaries, while others gambled in the non-stop crap games and poker tables. His vessel took on the appearance of a floating asylum being run by the inmates. When the second week rolled by, the tempers became shorter and petty quarrels burst into brief fistfights that were quickly broken up by cooler heads. Eventually, Scotland, with its lush green hills, came into sight, giving many of us a touch of homesickness after almost 3 weeks at sea. Marsh was then sent by train and truck to the 10th U.S. Army Replacement Depot at Litchfield, formerly Whittington Barracks. This had been the home of the North Staffordshire Regiment, and coincidentally was where this author started his military career. Perhaps a passage aboard a former Caribbean cruise ship, the 12,500-ton Santa Paula, best evokes the collective GI experience. Designed for 250 passengers, the transport was converted to take 2,200 troops and armed with 3-inch guns and 20mm anti-aircraft cannon. The records show that in her 4 years of war service, the Santa Paula made 28 troop-carrying voyages from the United States. Amongst others on this voyage, she was carrying the 756th Railway Shop Battalion, to join the nightmare life created by blackouts, ration restrictions, robot bombs, rockets, and other uncertainties in Buzz Bomb Alley, as the battalion history put it. Their job was to maintain the US Army's rolling stock in England and eventually France. But first, they had to endure the Atlantic. The Santa Paula was turned GI from stem to stern, except the engine room, which was off limits. Only a few of us escaped an attack of seasickness at some stage. Their historian described the typical crowded voyage. You make a mental calculation of how overloaded the ship is. After 3 days on the promenade deck, you finally get a bunk. And the next night, wander around like a lost soul trying to find a corner where it's fairly warm and dry, and hope nobody will step or stumble on you. Illness and boredom were the two chief characteristics for the millions of GIs who made the voyage. The tankers to port wallow as sickeningly as yesterday. Rain squalls occur regularly, and you're being washed down the scuppers with every wave that breaks. Half-hearted attempts are made to write letters. Some try and find oblivion in sleep. Everybody hopes the days will pass quickly and that soon we may stretch our legs again on a base that doesn't roll, pitch, or wobble. An occasional dry run with the AA guns causes momentary excitement, while the jangling bells, signifying lifeboat drill, at first demanding and peremptory in tone, are rapidly losing their effectiveness and became signals for just another chore. All these discomforts vanished when the ship was electrified into action as finally land was seen. Grey, rocky, cold, and forbidding, but brother, it is land. Eventually the inhabitants were sighted. The crowds on board Daffodil 2 seem cheery enough, and the girls lining its rails are left in no doubt that more Yanks are invading their land, and they rather give the impression of welcome. For Chuck Hurlburt aboard the SS Exchequer, it was Easter Sunday afloat that he most recalled. The chaplains got together and they put on an interfaith service up on deck. The Navy guys, the Army guys, they all were together. It was a simple service, just straightforward. But the setting, the ocean.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.